And I would like to welcome you all, partners and participants, to our today workshop, which is actually in cooperation between the Society of Cypriot Studies and the Department of Forests of the Ministry here in Cyprus, or Ministry of Agriculture here in Cyprus. And unfortunately, we did not have the possibility to organize this seminar, this workshop, as we had planned at the beginning in Cyprus, that would give the possibility to our partners to have insights of Cyprus and the deliverables that we had in the frame of the Balkan Med project under the title Mo.Na, Monuments in Nature. But at the least, we can have this possibility for a first approach and meeting for Cyprus, and in order to present what we have already concluded here in Cyprus, and to have a lot of participants who are going to give us very interesting papers. I would like to thank especially the European Center for Byzantine and Post-Byzantine Monuments for the whole cooperation and the help that we have also in different aspects. And I would like to begin with our webinar, giving the floor to Professor Natalia POULOU, who is chairman of the board of the European Center for Byzantine and Post-Byzantine Monuments. The center is the leader of the Mo.Na project, and we have a very good cooperation during these 2 years. And we hope that until the end of the project, which in the autumn of 2021, we're going to have all the deliverables ready in order to conclude what we have begun. So if Professor POULOU is here,
To be honest, she's trying to connect and she has a technical problem at this point. She just gave us a call saying that if it's possible to proceed, of course, we send to all of us her greetings, but she will connect later on.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Karagiani. Dr. Karagiani is the director of the European Center for Byzantine and Post-Byzantine Monuments in Thessaloniki, who is, as I told you, the leader of the project. We are very honored then to proceed with the greeting of the Cyprus Commissioner for the Environment, who is Mrs. Klelia Basileiou. And we would like to thank her very much for accepting our invitation, for her greetings in order to begin our Cyprus webinar. Mrs. Basileiou, you have the floor.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I will have to apologize at first for my voice. I should have stayed at home, but I did not. Today's subject is one of my favorite because the link between natural environment and culture seems identical. This being said, it is necessary to read more specifically the terms that natural environment and certainly to purify the word culture from any evidence we have occasionally added to the meaning. The modern dictates of our way of life and operation in recent decades seem to be moving towards distraction, both of the basic concept of the natural environment and against the very root of civilization. A kinder word for culture is the word citizen, whom we identify as protagonists in the issues of the natural environment. So the citizen is the one who defines either the natural or the cultural environment in which he lives and deals with. Over the past 10 years, humanity has seemed to turn to the basic principle of both interrelated mechanism, one defining the physical body by providing food, water, and air, through the ecosystem principles of biodiversity, and the other is the one that provides food for the spirit, for all that we can and cannot see or understand. The only certainty we have is that we are absolutely dependent on the purity of both mechanisms, which must operate in perfect harmony, not for the good of the planet, as we mistakenly believe, but for the good of humanity itself. Numerous conventions international, transnational, bilateral partnerships and strategies are on the agenda and give direction to the ways in which not the planet, but humanity is entitled to hope for its presence. Certainly, not only for the living present, not only for the parasitic presence in many cases, but for the well-being, health, but also the connection with cultural reserve that sets the levels of happiness for every person and every group of people. Man, as an active as well as social being, escaping the natural functions of the natural environment becomes a savage, abolishing the rational, which he possesses as an advantage over the other creatures of nature with whom he's called to coexist. As early as Platon is recorded that nature is the natural expression of the archetypical and ideal world, influencing to this day the aesthetic perception. Grave achievements of mankind have received inspiration from nature itself. According to Vitruvius, the inventor of the Corinthian rhythm was the sculptor Callimachus, who was inspired by a basket that lay on the grave of a girl in Corinth. The basket where her toys were placed was covered by a square plate. Around the basket has grown acanthus thorns following its shape. This is how the Corinthian rhythm was born, according to the legend. For those of us who have visited Barcelona, and the excellent Sagrada Familia is another such example, and while Gaudí was motivated by his faith, nature inspired the design of this unfinished Roman Catholic Church, which depicts the relationship between humanity, nature, and religion. It was designed according to the tree trunks and their branch foliage, which support the 45 meters high dome of the temple. Those who enter the church feel as if they are walking in a vast forest, just as Gaudí intended. Today, it looks as we have been cut off from this wonderful relationship, which moves against both our physical presence and the spiritual. Today is our last chance to bring this relationship back into harmony for our own good. I often think that in Cyprus, the enormous wealth of natural and cultural reserves makes us insolent, since the overcrowding of natural and cultural elements seems to us as much as given as not protected as it should be. Culture is our relationship with animals, with the bioclimatic elements that we create for our homes and buildings, the spirituality that we use for each interaction, and whether it spends the resources of the earth thoughtlessly or complies with the dictates of creating culture. I think in the last few years we have made strides, but we have to run even further to catch up with the magical natural and cultural world that we lose to our greed. Today's issue, specifically Paphos Forest, is one of my high importance themes for my office, as well as for the government. And there is a lot of actual and valuable work going on. And I would like to express to all of you my warmest wishes and appreciation for your work. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. And we have to say that we in Cyprus are very lucky and happy to have such a person for Commissioner for Environment who devotes so much time, as we see every day, for the environment. She's visiting all places that need her attention. And she's a person with special interest and sensibility for the environment. Therefore, we're very happy that you devote all your courage and power for this thing. And we hope to have the possibility also, when the time passes, when the situation is better in Cyprus, to visit also together the path in between Panagia and the Kykkos monastery that was opened by the Department of Forests, in order to show you what has been done in the frame of this European project, and to have your support. And we thank you so much that you were today with us.
I thank you.
And now allow me to give the speech to Professor Natalia POULOU, who is the chairman and, as we said before, of the board of the European Center for Byzantine and Post-Byzantine Monuments, as I told you, ECEVIM, which so the European Center is the leader of the Mo.Na project, and we have an excellent cooperation until now. And Dr. Natalia POULOU has the floor.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. CHOTZAKOGLOU and dear Charalampos. Kalimera. Dear colleagues, dear friends, good morning. I just would like to welcome you all in the Cyprus workshop entitled "In Initiative for Natural and Cultural Management and Protection, the Kykkos Forest as an Exemplary Model in the Framework of Mo.Na Project." As you know, all of you, the Mo.Na project implemented it with the, within the framework of Interreg Balkan Mediterranean is co-funded by the European Union and by national funds of participating countries. The project aims to record, analyze, assess, and contribute toward the protection and promotion of natural resources and cultural heritage across the Balkan Mediterranean territory. I would like just to say some a few words about the European Center of Byzantine and Post-Byzantine Monument. Is the leader, ECEVIM is the leader partner who conceived, drafted, and submitted the Mo.Na project. Our center was established in 1997. It is an institution under private law based in Thessaloniki, Greece, and supervised by the Minister of Culture and Sports. The activities of the center take place mainly in Greece, in the Middle East, the Balkan Peninsula, and the Black Sea, where there are preserved monuments of Byzantine culture or monuments of Byzantine cultural influence. ECEVIM, our center, coordinates the project, you know, very well, and a lot of municipalities, ephorates of antiquities, as the ephorate of antiquities of Cyclades, the municipality of Thera, the Hellenic Center for Marine Research, the municipality of Nesobar, the Society of Cypriot Studies, the Department of Forests of the Ministry of Agriculture, Rural Development and the Environment in Cyprus, and the National Institute of Cultural Heritage in Albania participate in the Mo.Na project with the support of the Ecumenical Patriarchate. The workshop in Cyprus is one of four technical meetings workshops that are implemented in the framework of Mo.Na project. The conclusions of the workshops will be the base of the thematic axis of the international conference in Athens in July 2021. So I would like to wish you every success to the workshop. Thank you very much.
We thank you, Professor Natalia POULOU, for this greeting. We are very happy that we have this wonderful cooperation with your institution. And it's really an amazing and exciting possibility that we have also to meet new partners, and the meetings that we had also in Thessaloniki, and we are looking forward for the next meeting in Athens, is something that contributes so much to the common objectives of the project. In this frame, I would like to underline that these projects, except of the scientific and the other parts of the that give the possibility to do and produce work, give us also the possibility to meet new persons, new people. And among these persons are Dr. Savas Yezekiel, who is going to read the greeting of Charalampos Alexandrou, the director of the Department of Forests, Ministry of Agriculture, Rural Development and Environment. I would like to underline, dear Savas, in front of all, because this is the truth, that I had the possibility to meet you in the frame of this project, and I met and I found an amazing person with love, care, and interest for the forest, for the nature, for flora and fauna. And I'm very happy that along with you and Nikos Kasinos, although in the same island, we had the possibility to meet and to create also a friendship. So Professor POULOU, the project is not only a project that brings a lot of different countries and persons together, but also gives the possibility to create new friendships that will give us the possibility also for the future to go on. Dr. Savas Ezekiel, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, dear Charalampos, dear partners and of Mo.Na Project, dear audience. Good morning to everybody. It is with great pleasure that we address today a short greeting on the online seminar held within the framework of the Mo.Na Project, aiming at the protection and promotion of the natural resources and cultural heritage through the Mediterranean and Balkan territory. Nature and culture are closely connected. Both have a vital role in determining who we are and how we are, we see the world. And we need to preserve both to build a cohesive, resilient world for the future. There is good evidence that the protected areas planned as part of larger and connected conservation networks offer practical, tangible solution to the problem of species loss and adaptation to climate change. Natural and cultural heritage suffer from similar range of threats and pressures and is best served by an integrated management approach to ensure their long-term sustainability. One of the main drivers of integration is due to the capacity of cultural and natural heritage sites to attract visitors. This can be both an advantage in terms of the recognition and branding and a challenge in ensuring the protection of these fragile assets. The European territory includes innumerable sites of great historical and archaeological importance, many of which also have natural values and are of this reason part of the Natura 2000 network. The Department of Forests of the Ministry of Agriculture, Rural Development and Environment, as the component of authority for the management of national forest land and for the implementation of national forest legislation and policy, is also responsible for the management of state forests that are part of the Natura 2000 network. The area under project in Cyprus is part of Paphos Forest, and it is included in the Natura 2000 site network for the effective protection and preservation of the biodiversity, species, and habitats they host. On the other hand, a large number of cultural and historical monuments are found in Paphos Forest, such as the Kykkos Monastery, old churches and chapels, historic Venetian bridges, old forest stations, kilns, heights, mines, and geological formations. Our purpose here is to highlight the importance of and creative coexistence of natural and cultural assets, including their potential to motivate and sustain public support for ecosystem protection. In conclusion, I would like to thank all partners of Mo.Na Project, especially the Society of Cypriot Studies that has taken the greatest responsibility for organizing this online seminar and consider this activity as another small step in the process of reconnecting rural and cultural capital and developing initiatives and synergies on cultural and natural management and protection. Thank you very much.
We thank you very much, you and the Department of Forests. And I believe that this cooperation in Cyprus, also with the Commissioner for the Environment and the Department of Forests, but also with the other partners that are going to be presented very soon, will give us the strength and the possibility to proceed and to give new initiatives for what we need in Cyprus, a small place, the half of it under Turkish occupation. So it's a place that needs our attention and interest. Therefore, I thank you also very much for your greetings. And with that, we proceed to the part to the first session of our webinar under the title Cultural Management. And as I told you, you know that the webinar has the title Initiatives for Natural and Cultural Management and Protection, the Kykkos Forest as an Exemplary Model. And as you will see also from our speakers, apart from the persons that we have met also the possibility to create very good cooperations with institutions, and representatives of these institutions are going to present you now their papers. So I give the floor to the moderator of the first session, Dr. Ioannis Eliades, who is a vice president of the Society of Cypriot Studies and among other director of the Byzantine Museum and the art galleries of the Archbishop Makarios Foundation. And I thank you very much for your cooperation.
Thank you very much, Charalampos. Good morning to everyone. I'm calling, I've got to tell to everyone that we've got to be strict in the 15 minutes for each speech, because the time is very strict, and some of us want to leave. So we've got to remain in our time. So I call the professor, Associate Professor Marios Pelekanos, architect, engineer in the Frederick University, to present the case of the timber-roofed basilicas of Troodos and the importance of the local materials.
Thank you very much, Yanis. Good morning to everyone. The timber-roofed basilicas of Troodos Mountain in Cyprus, which were built between the 15th and the 19th century, present a remarkable uniqueness, mainly due to their cleverly designed construction system. There are more than 130 churches of this type, and as far as typology is concerned, most of them are single-aisled or three-aisled. There is also a small number of two-aisled churches, all of them being the result of an extension of single-aisled church. Morphologically, the steep inclination of the roof and the general exterior appearance were associated by researchers with the Western European roofs and were attributed to the influence of the Franks who ruled the island from the 13th to the 16th century. The current research showed that despite the obvious external morphological resemblance, the basilicas of Troodos present a totally different constructional system. The unique constructional feature of these basilicas is the existence of two distinctive but cooperating parts of the roof. The inner roof can be conceived as a rigid triangular prism, which is based on the southern and northern walls. The outer roof, which carries the heavy tiles, is actually suspended from the inner roof, and it overhangs the two long walls. The construction of the inner roof starts with the placement of two wall plates on which tie beams are connected. Between tie beams, pieces of wood keep the right distances. Two square-shaped beams are then completing what we call the composite box-like beams on the two walls and integrating them to the transverse tie beams. Rafters are placed every 30 to 40 centimeters and hold the connective ridge purlin called carina. Several wooden sections are placed in order to close firmly the gaps of the interior cover. The inner roof is completed with the placement of the wooden boards over the rafters. A special horizontal beam is then nailed temporarily to the rafters and is supported by strut supports. In this way, the heavy load of the outer roof is directed mainly on the strong transverse tie beams. After the inner roof is completed, the outer roof is ready to be suspended from the special horizontal beam. On top of the rafters, wooden purlins are nailed every 10 centimeters to hold the coming tiles. Every tile covers the lower one by its two-thirds, and all joints are crossed, achieving in this way the full waterproofing of the roof. A comprehensive constructional analysis showed that most of the characteristics of this type of construction are similar to what we call the Eastern type roofs. the timber circumferential binding called imantosis in Greek, the box-like integral behavior of the entire structure, the uniform distribution of the loads throughout the structure, the relative flexibility of the connection, and its hyperstatic behavior. Timber roofs in the seismic area of the Eastern Mediterranean are constructed in such a way mainly to cope successfully with the frequent earthquake phenomena. Among other objectives, this particular design concept incorporates a remarkable provision for an easy repair intervention at any later stage during a basilica's long life. The first provision noted is the easy deassembling of the outer roof when needed. The outer roof is apparently more vulnerable than the inner one, and the builders were aware of this weakness. Their decision to form the outer roof as a constructionally autonomous part seems to be their answer to confront successfully this unavoidable problem. By dismantling all flat tiles and removing the small tile purlins, all other parts can be easily dismantled and removed in order to be replaced or reused. This process keeps the inner roof untouched and the interior of the church unaffected during the repair works, an achievement which is important and essential for a functioning church. A second provision is the easy process to replace the important tie beam on the exterior of the west and sometimes the east facade. The builders were once again aware of the vulnerability of this exterior tie beam as it was directly exposed to the weather conditions. Exactly because they knew that the existence of this tie beam was essential for a successful box-like anti-seismic behavior, they had to provide a way for it to be easily dismantled and replaced just before it would be totally destroyed. The third provision is the easy deassembling and removal of many parts of the roof in such a way that it could leave most of the remaining wooden parts unaffected and reusable. As mentioned before, most of the numerous joints of the roof present fixing without any nail, making the replacement of all affected and the reuse of all unaffected members an easy task at any stage in the future life of the construction. The bioclimatic behavior of the basilicas is remarkable. The overhanging part of the roof protects a significant part of the stone wall from the direct sunlight. This design feature reduces the heat radiation on the stone wall and it lowers the surface temperature. Despite the significant decrease of the heat radiation from the tiles, the air between the outer and the inner roof is heated. The great slope of the roof and the triangular shape of its section help the hot air to travel not only upwards, but also faster. At the highest point of the roof, the builders left both edges on the east-west direction open to the outside air. In this way, the heated air is naturally channeled outwards, achieving a perfectly ventilated double-skin timber roof in the 15th century. The ongoing research has recorded more than 130 basilicas dated from the 15th to the 19th century. Their location on a map of Cyprus shows their concentration in the area of Troodos between four districts. Researchers in the past suggested that the steep inclination of the roof was adopted because of the heavy rainfall and snow on the area of Troodos. Indeed, the geophysical map of Cyprus shows that the number of basilicas increase as one moves at higher altitudes, but here some questions arise. First, although the Pentadactylus range has many of its area at high altitudes, there is not a single basilica at that area. Second, there is a significant number of basilicas in the area of Troodos that lie at very low altitudes. And third, there is not an obvious explanation why aren't there any basilicas in the southwest part of the Troodos range. It is true that the higher the rainfall, the denser is the presence of the basilicas. On the other hand, there is a significant number of basilicas that belong to areas with very, very low rainfall, a fact that weakens the correlation between location and heavy rainfall. Investigating the role between location and heavy snowfall seems even more groundless. The basic building materials of the basilicas were timber for the roof, the gray volcanic stone for the bearing walls, and the red soil for the roof tiles. An interesting question would be where these materials came from. The boundary of the pine forest seems to play an important role as far as the location of the basilicas is concerned. It is clear that all the basilicas are located either in or very near the forest boundary. This observation can be translated in technical terms that all basilicas were located in areas where timber supply was easy and unlimited. A close examination on the geological map of the island reveals that the actual boundaries where the Troodos volcanic stone is found differ a lot from what we call today the Troodos range. This gray local stone can be found only in the central and northeast part of the range, while its northern edge actually reaches the sea. The same geological boundary exists also for the presence of the volcanic red soil. A map that combines the location of all the 130 basilicas and the geological boundary of Troodos shows that 125 of them, the majority of them, are included within this boundary, where one could find this hard volcanic stone and the red soil for the roof tiles making. This observation justifies that the easy and limited access to the three basic building materials was a factor affecting strongly the appearance and outspread of the timber roofed basilicas of Troodos. Based on the facts mentioned above, it is suggested that this geological boundary is the most probable answer to the three questions raised at the beginning of this presentation. That is, why Pentadactylus range has not a single timber roof basilica? Second, why there are basilicas at very low altitudes? And third, why aren't there any basilicas in the southwest part of the Troodos range? If this is actually a rule, then it should have its exemptions. The walls of several basilicas in the Solea Valley were erected by combining gray stone at the base of the bearing walls and mud bricks on their upper part. This valley is known for its thick and fertile red soil land with wheat plantations, both of them being the basic materials for mud brick making. A second exception confirms the rule. Five basilicas located just outside the southwest geological boundary of Troodos were built with limestone. Again, the geological map gives an answer. All five basilicas are located within the scattered limestone boundaries to the south of Troodos. This justifies the suggestion that the decision for the most suitable building material was based on the proximity and ease of access to it. This short presentation aimed at showing the importance of the use of local materials in the creation and evolution of a specific type of structure in the past. In our days, when almost everything can be ordered and delivered worldwide, this value may appear strange and incomprehensible. It is our duty, though, to bring this principle to light as it could serve in our effort, which is to achieve a sustainable way of building in the future. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Pelikanos. It was very interesting, the observation about the volcanic areas and where they were built, these timber roof basilicas. Professor is going to leave. If you have any question to make to him, we are going to accept one question, please. Okay, we can proceed to the next speaker. Is Dr. George Michailidis, is a civil engineer specializing on water resources engineering and environmental management, and his assistant professor at the same university, at the Frederick University in Cyprus. Mr. Michailidis?
Could you close the PowerPoint, Mr. Pelikanos?
Yes. Okay. Yes, thank you, sorry.
Can you all see my presentation? Well, my presentation's title is Rainwater Harvesting in Cyprus. Let me initially introduce the subject. Rainwater harvesting, or direct collection of rainwater, refers to a roof catchments, that is from roofs of buildings, mainly for domestic use, and B, ground catchments, usually used for agriculture and watering of livestock. In a typical roof catchment system, gutters and downpipes carry rainwater to storage after interception. Components of the system: precipitation. By precipitation, I mean everything that falls from the sky, for example, rain, snow, hail, etc. Collection of rainwater and storage of the rainwater. Here you see a diagram of a typical roof catchment system. Basically, it's the roof, the gutter, the downpipe, and the storage tank. The system includes storage of water since precipitation is seasonal. The tanks should be covered to control evaporation and maintain water quality. Rainwater harvesting is a preferable water supply system where surface water, by surface water, I mean river, lake, and dam water, is either not available or is costly and complicated to treat, or where groundwater is unsuitable for consumption or expensive to exploit. Rainwater harvesting is an ancient process that has been receiving recently attention in developing countries. There are some areas in the world that are entirely dependent on rainwater harvesting. For other regions, it is the main source of water supply. Rainwater harvesting is a small scale, locally implemented technique. The benefits from the system are saving water since it can be used, recharge of groundwater, recharge means increase, and minimizing floods. Let me give you shortly the background, my background in the subject. Part A, research on the quality of roof harvested rainwater was carried out. An idealized rainwater harvesting system with no water treatment was designed. It was built in the island of Mauritius, which is situated in the Indian Ocean. Continuous weekly tests were carried out. The results of total fecal coliform examination were acceptable. Coliforms is indicator of bacteria. Fecal coliforms is a more specific indicator of fecal pollution. By fecal pollution, we mean contamination of water with disease-causing organisms. So this examination, it was acceptable by World Health Organization guidelines in 80% of the 55 samples that were taken. The aesthetic water quality parameters that were frequently tested were within World Health Organization guidelines. This is the system that was built in Mauritius. You may see the roof, the gutter, the downpipe, and the storage tank. Part B, roofs and gutters accumulate pollutants during dry periods. The initial precipitation at the beginning of the storm is known as the foul flash. Where a rainwater harvesting system is designed to provide a potable supply, it is essential that this foul flash is prevented from entering storage and contaminating the water body. The efficiency of various designs of foul flash diverters was examined by the author through a series of laboratory experiments at Dundee University, Scotland. A picture of the experiments at the university. Here we see rainwater harvesting, part C, the water resources management for the island of Rodrigues, a dependency of Mauritius, was investigated. The purpose of this work was to survey existing rainwater harvesting and other water supply practices, to investigate how feasible rainwater harvesting was, and to offer recommendations for improvement. Here you can see in the picture rainwater harvesting as practiced at the house in the island of Rodrigues. Part D, design of a rainwater harvesting system for a tea factory in Mauritius to satisfy the water needs of the factory. Now I will talk about the history of rainwater harvesting in Cyprus. Engomi and Salamis, during the Copper period, 3,900 to 2,500 years BC, the people used to build their houses in high fortified sites so as to protect themselves from the enemies and to secure water sources for their needs. Earthen and stone channels carried the rainwater to cisterns. By cisterns, we mean tanks for storage purposes. Visaja settlement in Larnaca existed from about 2,000 to 1,000 years BC. Substrate, stone-built wells and stone-cut canals leading water to or from cisterns have been found by archaeologists who dated them as starting in the 16th century BC. A picture of a stone-cut canal in the Zaja area. Another two settlements, Ma Paleogastro in the west coast of the island and Bilago Echinogramos in the southeast of the island. Intense political changes mark the year 1200 BC as a result of the breakdown of the Mykenaean Empire. It was in that period that the two new castle settlements appeared in Cyprus. There were no wells and the inhabitants were storing water in large earthenware jars. The water was rainwater harvested from the roofs of the houses. Palace of Uni, cisterns or water reservoirs are situated within the settlements with internal coating of lime mortar. An example is the Palace of Uni of the 5th century BC. Alassa, in the district of Lemesos, channels, the picture shows channels collecting rainwater. Tseri, near Nicosia, a built covered cistern of the year 300 BC, an impressive underground construction with stairs. The internal surface of the walls, the ceiling and the joints of the stairs were faced with plaster, insulated material, especially durable in moisture. This discovery enhances our knowledge about the history of the development of the water resources in areas such as Tseri, where specific conditions of drought exist. The people of the area applied methods of locating, collection, storage, and transfer of valuable water. During the Roman times, the water was a very important element of the everyday life of the citizens. Installations like baths, reservoirs, cisterns, and aqueducts were known in all parts of the empire, including Cyprus. Kurion, the atrium of the house of Epstolios. Atrium is the internal yard of a building. End of the 4th, beginning of the 5th century AC, after Christ, had a small cistern and a fountain. Soli, the archaeologically confirmed existence of the spring fountain and the cistern adjoined the hypogeal chamber. Hypogeal means underground, most probably the place where Saint Auxilius was buried. It seems that they coexisted since the beginning of the 5th century. Amathus, a building complex was discovered near the basilica, which consisted of, among others, two large cisterns excavated in the rock. The monastery was built by Saint John the Merciful in the 6th century. Mesaida, Gidonia in Lemesos, an ancient settlement probably founded during the Byzantine times. There is a medieval cistern. The emblem of the municipality of Mesaida is the cistern. Colossi Castle, there are two underground cisterns in the ground floor, which was probably used as a store. Abesha village in Lemesos district, there's a stone built arched underground cistern, which was used for storing the rainwater. It was the work of the Byzantines. Saint Hilarion Castle, Leonardo Donna, a famous Venetian, visited the castle in the 16th century. He mentioned the existence of cisterns. Holy Monastery of Kykkos, the Russian monk Vasily Grigorovich Basky visited the monastery twice in 1727 and 1735. In his second visit, he wrote, they have two annexes with wells, cleverly wrought in such a way as to collect the rainwater under the earth to supply the needs of the monastery. Right up to 1940, the rainwater, which is stored in cisterns in winter, was used as drinking water by the inmates of the monastery and by visitors. as well as supplying other needs. This was because apart from an irregular supply a little away from the monastery, there was no other spring water available. We see the following inscription in system C. We'll see it a bit later in slides. So the inscription mentioned that the water was stored in the time of the Reverend Abbot Sophronios, October 26, 1734. The visitor was Monk Christodoulos. The monastery was visited by the author in February 2021. System 1, it was built in 1750. It is situated in the upper courtyard. Rainwater is collected from the roof. Its depth is about 3.5 meters. The system is stone built. In the past, it was used by the people of the area for domestic use other than drinking and for watering animals. Now it is used for floor cleaning and watering plants. An electric pump is used. It was cleaned 5 to 6 years ago. A picture of it, we can see the roof, the downpipe. This is the storage tank. You may see an inscription here. This is the inscription. Again, the same system. System one again. Now system two, it is situated in front of the synodic room. It is filled with roof collected rainwater. Its roof is arched. It is not used anymore. It was for some time used as museum and since 1996 as icon shop. This is system two, entry to the system, entry to the system. Now this is how it looks today. Inside, it's now an icon shop. System three, situated in the lower courtyard, fed entirely from roof collected rainfall, not used anymore, emptied to avoid damage on buildings. In the past, it was connected to system two. We can see now system three. Again, system three. There are two other systems. There are also two other systems near the monastery. Now we talk about the Holy Monastery of Stavrovouni. Until recently, the monastery used rainwater, which was collected in cisterns. Lania village in Lemesos district, there were at least three monasteries, feuds during the Frankish domination. One of them was Valanas in the area where today the homonymous chapel exists. Among other findings, systems were found. Yeri, near Nicosia, the Church of Panagia Chrysogeorgiotis is situated on the right of a hill and is the oldest the church of Yeri. It was built on the foundations of a Byzantine monastery dedicated to Panagia Lipu. Among other findings of the monastery, an underground built system collecting water was preserved. Lofu village in Lemesos district, visited recently by the author. The total volume of the cisterns is 250 cubic meters. The picture shows the cistern in the yard of the chapel of St. George. There's a cistern visited by the author, which is still in use in a house in Lofu. We can see the cover of the cistern. The same house, we can see the downpipe from the roof. Gelagi village in Lemesos district. There is an old cistern in Gelagi. It was built in 1929 and it was restored in the year 2005 by the community council of the village and the immigrants of the village. There are some localities in Cyprus with the name Sterna. Sterna is the Greek name for cistern. For example, in Gathikas village in Bafos district with the name Sterna. In Sodira village in Lemesos district with the name Sternes. Now, what about the future prospects in Cyprus? Here there is some, I will describe some public study. In the year 2009, the Water Development Department, the governmental department in Cyprus, assigned to consultants the preparation of a study on ways to exploit rainwater. The aims of the study were to consider the prospective exploitation of rainwater, i.e. when collected from the main urban areas, and conveyance of it to existing or new dams or aquifers. Aquifer is an underground layer saturated with water, and B, when collected from houses or buildings. The study included a review of the practices in other countries, either for conserving water or minimizing flood intensity. The report, which included also the views of all concerned organizations, was submitted in December 2009. One of the findings of the study was the slicing of the responsibility for the collection and shedding of rainwater. Shedding means disposal of rainwater. One of the recommendations was to give incentives for the collection of rainwater at the household level. According to a supplementary report of September 2010, the cost of exploitation of rainwater was estimated at 2.2 million euros per kilometer square. The average quantity of exploitable water was in the range of 129,600 to 193,600 cubic meters per square kilometer for the six areas that comprise the study. The conclusion was that the exploitation of rainwater in urban areas should only be carried at the house level, since it would not be cost effective to change the existing practice of rainwater disposal. Ever since, no actions were taken to implement the recommendations. One of the measures included in the preliminary plan of the management of flood control 2016 to 2020 was rainwater collection works at a private level. Here I have done an estimate for a simple estimate for a house. If the average rainfall in Cyprus is 300 millimeters per year, then 300 liters of water will fall on an area of one square meter. If the area of the roof of a medium house is 200 square meters, then 60 cubic meters of water will be collected per year. According to research work, only 80% of the water is collected. Thus, 48 meters cube per year is collected. Note, about one third of the consumption and hygiene needs can be satisfied with this amount of water. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Mikhailidis. The subject was very interesting and is very crucial for Cyprus at this moment. We have a shortage of water, and it was also interesting to see how our ancestors were using to fill the tanks with water for uses to make economy of water and use it in other purposes. We go further to, just a moment, I would like to thank also the University of Frederick University for the cooperation with the Society of Cyprus Studies. We have also a memorandum of understanding between the two organizations, but also to thank that for the collaboration for our project. And now I call Dr. Chrysanthos Pissaridis, architect, town planner, conservator, president of the Cyprus ICOMOS, coordinator of monuments and traditional construction of Cyprus Scientific and Technical Chamber, treasurer of the Association of the Architects of Cyprus, to present his paper about old bridges of Troodos.
Thank you so much, Ioannis. Good morning to all, dear commissioner, dear participants, dear Mr. Khotzakoglou, thank you for your invitation. A bridge is an architectural or technical structure built to span physical or artificial obstacles without closing the way underneath for the purpose of providing passage over an obstacle, thus joining two or more opposite ends. The fact that most of the rivers in Cyprus are passable and easily accessible, since for the most part of the year, they tend to dry up, has to a great extent led to the significant diminution in the number of bridges in the island, especially in the lowland regions. Most bridges are located over the rivers Xeros, the Arizos, and Hapotami in the Paphos region, as well as over the Yalia, Pedios, and Yamasoya rivers. The materials that can be found on said arch bridge, construction stones, bricks, and other such materials have the ability to sustain very large compressive forces, however, do not have the capacity of enduring tension stress forces. As a result, in order to compensate for this vulnerability, these bridges were designed to be strong enough and constantly under compression, so far as is possible, to withstand and absorb compression. In the case of compression arch bridges, a keystone in the middle of the bridge bears the weight of the rest of the bridge and forces. The more weight is put onto the bridge, the stronger its structure becomes. Masonry arch bridges use a quantity of fill material, typically compacted rubble, above the arch in order to increase this dead weight on the bridge and prevent any tension from occurring in the arch ring as heavy loads from across the bridge, such as camels transporting copper. Arch bridges are typically faced using square blocks of limestone, whereas their inner side is composed of regular, roughly axed limestone blocks. In addition, the deck of said bridges is built of small copper stones, and the curvature of the arch is designed with the proper inclination angle so as to facilitate the use of the bridge by foot passengers, horseback riders, and carriages. Today, 19 out of the 29 bridges that survive in Cyprus can be found within the Rhodes Geopark area, all of which have been declared ancient monuments under the antiquities law. Said bridges date back to the years of Frankish, Venetian, and Ottoman domination, although their dating cannot be accurately determined, given that the ogival arch was a popular architectural feature which was widely used even up until the past century. And what's more, the semicircular arch, whose construction is assumed to have been abandoned during the period of the Frankish rule, is often found in the period of both the Venetian and the Ottoman domination of Cyprus. The majority of these old bridges are located in the mountainous areas of Cyprus, mainly within the Troas region and the Troas Geopark. The oldest bridges that exist today in Cyprus date only as far as the medieval period, given that the bridges which were constructed during the classical antiquity or the Byzantine period are either no longer in existence or replaced. That is, their structure have been used for the erection of the bridges that survived and are still standing today. Worth mentioning is the fact that 14 of these bridges are located in the Limassol district of Cyprus, 3 in the Paphos district, and only 2 of them are found in the Nicosia district. So, 7 bridges are located over Kouris River, 6 over the Arizos River, 2 bridges within the Marthasa area, 2 over Xeros and Xehus rivers, 1 over Kapodami, and 1 over Vasilikos River. Most of said bridges are found on remote mountainous areas where their presence is required due to the particularities of the soil, as well as the deep, steep valleys with streams or rivers running along their bottom. Moreover, the majority of these bridges are situated in the winemaking regions of Cyprus. The Venetian stone board bridge of Chelefou, together with the other 2 Venetian stone bridges, the Ilia and the Rudia bridge, were constructed in the mountains as part of the so-called Camilostrada, literally translated as Camel Road, a route used by camel caravans during the period of Venetian rule of Cyprus to transport copper and other materials from the Rhodes Mountains and the mines across to the port of South Paphos for export. The type and size of these bridges varies depending on the size of the river basin they had to cover, the span and height differences between the 2 points they had to connect, the locally available materials used to make them, the era of their construction, their workmanship, as well as on the expertise and know-how of their builders. The 19 bridges, stone bridges of the Troodos Mountains, may be informally divided into 3 categories based on their numbers of arches they have. The single arch bridge, as the majority, namely 17 of said bridges are. The double arch bridge, as the bridge of POULOU is, and the 3 arch bridge, as is the case of Trimigrini bridge. Single arch bridges, to which category most bridges belong to, can be further classified into 2 broad categories. The ogival or Gothic style pointed arch, we have 9 bridges, and the semicircular arch, we have 8 bridges. Each of these 2 categories can also be divided into two other subcategories depending on the type of the bridge's deck. That is whether the arch bridge has a flat surface or a curved geometry, that being sloped transversally. 10 of the ancient bridges under investigation are shaped with a flat deck to facilitate passage, whereas the other six are designed with a curved deck. Due to lack of sufficient time and the high numbers of surviving bridges in the following section, we shall take a closer look at one bridge at least from each category. So, the ancient bridge of Drimiklini, located in the Drimiklini village area, is built on the bed of Kouris River and consists of three uneven arches, with the biggest one having an opening of 8 meters, and the other two being an equal of 2.6 meters opening each. The bridge has a total length of 30 meters, 0.35, with 2.53 meters width, and its deck is flat. The floating of the center pier column of the bridge has a pointed projection that follows the orientation of the river flow to ensure and provide greater resistance against stresses. Crossing over the Kouris River, the bridge used to connect the wider area of the wine-producing village of Limassol with the one in the buffer district of Cyprus. Unfortunately, one of the bridge's three arches has been illegally sealed up with soil. And that is why I should like to take this opportunity from this platform to appeal for its reinstatement. Please help to have it back. According to local folk tradition, the story of the bridge is connected to that of the three of the route followed by the Byzantine Empress St. Helen herself, as she set off from Stavrogonia and crossed over the bridge, transporting the Holy Cross and Holy Rope to the ancient monument, monastery of the Holy Cross in Kouka village and Domos. The stone bridge in the medieval village of Agapnou, in the Bitsilia region, comprises two arches, each having an opening of 5.6 meters, one of pointed form over the river, the other a semicircular arch of lower height. The bridge has an overall width of 2.3 meters, which, subtracting the thickness of the lateral parapets, leaves a narrow passageway only 1.3 to 1.4 meters wide, enough for camels or donkeys, not for cars for sure. The footing of the center pier of the bridge has a projection pointing towards the direction of the river flow to ensure that and provide greater resistance against stresses. The bridge joins the road leading from Agapnou village to the village areas of Vikla and Kronari in the Limassol district of Cyprus, and the deck of the bridge here is also flat. The bridge arch, the single arch for the new bridge is situated in the medieval village of Potamiu, one of Cyprus' premier wine villages, and is built on the west bank of the Hapatami River. It has a flat deck and an asymmetrical pointed arch with a span opening of 5.9 meters and a width of 3 meters, whereas its total length is 11 meters. Among the eastern bank of the river run two ancient trails serving as the continuum of the bridge. One path used to lead to the village of Uni, while the other to the once administrative and commercial center of Kilani village. The western bank trail of the river and the Potamiu bridge were used to passerby merchants and miners coming from Paphos and the area in which Omogos village is situated. The pointed arch and the flat deck also constitute distinctive features of the bridge of Milos near the village of Triselias that has an engraved cross on both sides. The bridge of Polendri in Gardagi area, the Galopanayotis bridge near the monastery of Agios Ioannis, St. John Lambadistis, as well as of the bridge between the villages of Kalapanayotis and Igos, which has undergone an extension during the early 20th century, with the result that today the bridge carries two roadways, one intended for pedestrians and one to be used by carriages. The ancient bridge of Chelefos on the river of Rouvias, a tributary of the Diarizos River, is located within the deep forest of Paphos, near the Turkish Cypriot village of Agios Nikolaos in the Paphos district of Cyprus. The Chelefos Bridge, which is of a much later date than all the rest, has a pointed arch with a span opening of 10.15 meters, a width of 3.15 meters, and a total length of 25.62 meters. The extremities of the arch bridge are built of bricks. The exterior stone cladding of the bridge is comprised of squared limestone blocks, whereas the underside of the bridge is made of irregular stone blocks. In addition, the curved bridge deck is paved with copper stones from the river. The entrances at either end of the bridge appear to have a flattened space, presumably serving as a waiting area for passengers, which clearly indicates that there was intense activity during the Middle Ages. Furthermore, the pointed arch and the curved deck design are also characteristics of two other bridges, one in Pelendri, near village of Agios Mamas, and another in the village of Fini, known as the Lia, meaning olive tree bridge. Both Chelefos and the Lia bridge, as we've seen before, form part of the Gambinostrada, the old Venetian camel trail. A clay plaque with an engraved cross is affixed on the south side of the Lia bridge, decorating the bridge's keystone. The bridge of Piskopou is located within walking distance from Fini village and dates as far back as the Byzantine period. The bridge is 2.4 meters wide, spans a distance of 16.45 meters, and has a semicircular arch with an opening of 8.9 meters. The ends of the bridge are made of irregular shaped stone blocks and faced with roughly axed limestone blocks. According to tradition, the Piskopou bridge, meaning a Christian bishop, of course, of Agion and Argyron, who used the particular bridge trail to get to Baros. The deck of the bridge is also flat. The Agia Mavri bridge in the village of Kilani, the Milia bridge in the mountainous village of Panopladres, the three olives bridge, as well as the bridge of Stavrou in the mountainous village of Fini, are all flat deck bridges consisting also of a singular semicircular arch and a flat deck. The bridge of Rutia, which a tributary of the Xeros River, is located at a shelling hidden area inside the Baphos forest between the Turkish Cypriot village of Agios Ioannis and Vrecha. The bridge has an arch opening of 10.05 meters, a width of 3.65 meters, a total length of 22.37 meters. The Rodia Bridge, which estimated to have been constructed during the 16th century, was nearly destroyed by the powerful earthquake of 1953 and rebuilt again, thanks to the Department of Antiquities, in 1975 to 76. The bridge is made of regular blocks of stone and faced with square limestone blocks, as is also its parapets. The deck of the bridge still preserves the original pavement made of copper stone from the river. It probably owes its name, of course, to a bush called Rudy. The Rudia Bridge is one of the three bridges, again, constitute the so-called Kamerostrada. Similar bridges exhibiting a single semicircular arch but curved deck are the bridge of Milos and at the Krios Potamos River near Kirani village, and the Scarfu village located close to the village of Simo in Paphos area. All bridges have parapets of 40 to 50 centimeters, which renders their passageway rather narrow, thus difficult to cross. The height of the parapets ranges between 30 and 50 centimeters. Parapets were built from soft porous stone, which was roughly axed into stone plates. our surviving ancient bridges, fountains, aqueducts, and wells, together with our local folk architecture and the religious monument, constitute an internal part of our heritage and our past, thus acting as witnesses of the era in which they were built, as well as of the period that followed up until today. Stone bridges represent examples of best construction practices of previous eras, and as such, they embody a precious arsenal of knowledge, wisdom, and craftsmanship pertaining to the architecture and the art of construction of the epoch in which they were built, capable of ensuring the continuous transmission of this unique wealth of information and expertise across generations. Thank you so much.
Dear Chrysanthos, Vissaridis, very well done. Very interesting, all this presentation of all the types of the bridges. And it was also very interesting that you have shown, presented the Rudias bridge, from where the trail that we prepared from Kykkos to Christorogiadisa passes through. And we're looking forward to see all this, all your work, all your research also published in the from the project. And now I'm calling Mrs. Dr. Flora Karagiani, the director of the Center of Byzantine and Post-Byzantine Monuments, the leader of our project of Barkanmet, and I would like to thank her as a representative of the Society of Cypriot Studies for inviting the society to be part of this project, and for the great cooperation that we have all these years with EKEVIM. Mrs. Dr. Karagiani, please talk us about the management of the Byzantine monuments of Thessaloniki.
Thank you, dear Yannis. Thank you all. After these very beautiful landscapes of Cyprus, let me travel you to Thessaloniki to give you an analogous example of some very high importance monuments preserved there. Thessaloniki, as you know, is privileged to preserve in its urban grid more 15 Byzantine monuments of great importance that are inscribed in UNESCO's World Heritage List even from 1988. So these monuments consists of some very impressive parts of the Roman and mainly Byzantine walls that run from the slopes of the upper part of the city until the sea. The towers and the Acropolis, and of course the famous Heptapyrgion, the so-called as well Yedikule, with its impressive plan. Besides this very unique fortification system, Thessaloniki also preserves a unique monument, the Byzantine bath of the Middle Byzantine era, inscribed as well in this UNESCO's list, as well as 13 ecclesiastical monuments early Christian of the early Christian period, basilicas as well as the rotunda, early Middle Byzantine monuments such as the Agia Sophia and the Panagia Chalkeion, as well as late Byzantine monuments such as the Hagia Apostoli, the Saint Pantaleimon, the Agia Ekaterini, Saint Nicholas Orphanos, Vlatavon Monastery, Saint the Church of the Transfiguration of the Savior, as well as the Prophet Elijah Monastery. All these monuments are of great historical and religious value, and they consist either pilgrimage centers like Saint Demetrius, the famous Byzantine pilgrimage center of the whole Byzantine Empire and as well as, or even the cathedral of the city, which was besides the fact that it was the main ecclesiastical center of this major bishopric, it all was also connected with great personalities, archbishops, such as the Saint Simeon of Thessaloniki, who wrote all these amazing texts through which we gain a lot of information regarding the history of the monument, as well as monuments related to some very important personalities of the Paleologan era, a period in which Thessaloniki was a very thriving one. I present you here the Vlatavon Monastery with the, in which the earliest presentation of Saint Grigory the Palamas, who was initially buried in the monument, is preserved. Besides, though, their religious character, on the other hand, all of them, with no exception, are of great architectural and artistic value. They are representative monuments of almost a school that has been developed in the architectural framework of the co-capital of the Byzantine Empire during mainly the late Byzantine period, or they are masterpieces of art, which is nowadays preserved in the exquisite mosaics, such as the ones you see here, or the frescoes that reflect the high quality of the art that has been developed in the city. The protection and preservation of these monuments is the first priority of the Ministry of Culture and, of course, of the local Ephorate of Antiquities, the Ephorate of Antiquities of Thessaloniki, which has to go through a series of issues within the framework of their management. This preservation, although it is obvious that has to be made, is not always an easy task, because in the majority of the cases, many factors should be taken under consideration that indicate the challenging character of their management. In regards to the management of the monuments of Thessaloniki, let me share with you some thoughts on the challenges we face in the archaeological service almost all day. First of all, the first thing one should take care of is the absolute control of the appropriate temperature and humidity that will secure the protection of the frescoes and mosaics inside and prevent, of course, them from any damages. This so simple task becomes a major issue and a challenge, of course, because as you very well know, between the 15th Byzantine monuments of the city inscribed in UNESCO's lists, the 13 are churches, which mean living religious places which celebrate the Holy Liturgy, and not only that, also all the rest of the ecclesiastical ceremonies in the regular basis within a circle of a year. In the non-COVID era, all these places were full of people, both in the winter and in the summer, and in many cases, the heating systems of the churches include old-fashioned oil or halogen stoves that are considered as a real threat for the security of the monument, not to mention that they create an equal range of temperature inside the monument. As you can understand, the energy upgrade of these monuments is one of the priorities of the Ephorate, of course, of the ministry as a whole. I will give you a very characteristic example for the case of St. Nicholas Orphanos of Thessaloniki, which, as you all know, preserves a very, very important and a very high quality total of ecclesiastical of frescoes dated in the 14th century. In the interior of the church, even today, that are preserved heaters as well as ventilators such as these ones for the winter and for the, of course, for the summer. As a result, besides the bad image that the interior shows within all these ugly machines, the major problem is that the whole system very often suffers from short circuit, which is a constant threat that increases the possibility of fire, which is, of course, something that we don't even want to imagine. On the other hand, as you can understand, those frescoes that are very close to the heaters are the victims of the high temperature when the heaters are on, and a few hours later when the heaters are off, a very low temperature, and some of them get damaged due to the lack of a stable condition. So what the F4A did in order to prevent all these issues related to them, to the controlling of the temperature, is that a team of experts prepared the project of a new system based on an holistic air conditioning project that will provide stable environmental conditions in the interior, and they will secure the protection and preservation of the exquisite frescoes. So we really examined a lot all the places in the peristone of the church in which the new heating machines will be located, so that they will never prevent both the iconographical program of the church, and at the same time they will really control and secure that all the monument in the interior will have stable conditioning temperature. Of course, this issue is not only issue of the heating system and system for cold in the summer, is not only for the issue for St. Nicholas, but also for all the other churches. And of course, not to mention that in all these new projects, which we are really intensively working on, a strong effort is undertaken in order to succeed to have energy upgraded buildings and places where machines and their cables will stop affecting the frescoes. I will give you a very characteristic example of what we would never like to imagine that would happen in a Byzantine monument. So this is not from Thessaloniki. This monument is in a country outside Greece. It doesn't matter which monument it is, but as you can see, in order to secure to have control of the heating system, they destroyed part of the frescoes that were preserved in this wall. Something that we cannot even imagine that nowadays that would happen in the Byzantine monuments. On the other hand, the second parameter related to these churches has to do with the cultural use of the monuments. Since almost all of them preserve exquisite examples of their early Christian and Byzantine art, they almost function as a kind of museums. Taking this parameter under serious consideration, the teams of experts, archaeologists, architects, and civil engineers from several fields are working together in order to implement projects that will make the monuments accessible to everybody, even to the disabled people. Let me show you now the example of Agia Sophia in Thessaloniki, in which the local F4A really works a lot in order to create, to develop a study for the configuration of the eastern mainly part of the monument. Nowadays, a project has been submitted to the Central Archaeological Council for approval. As you can see now how is the current situation with a lot of buildings and stuff that is really stored in the courtyard of the monument, which is now which will be replaced by corridors for the visitors, as well as by corridors for the disabled people. Speaking on Agia Sophia, I would also like to mention a very challenging project that one of the restoration of the galleries of the monument, where the visitors for the first time will have the amazing opportunity to see the domes of the monument from their upper part. The implementation of the project that has been approved by the Ministry of Culture has just started to be implemented, and through which all the visitors, even from the pedestrian road of the northern part of the monument, will have access directly to the galleries of the monument through a series of corridors. The visitors will have the opportunity to walk around the nave from the upper part, and of course, being able to see these magnificent domes. exactly due to the fact that the UNESCO monuments are cultural places, the ministry provides to the bodies of the city the organizing also to have a lot of events inside, starting so from the Eptapyrion, which has recently been restored and acquired some places of the both of the post-Byzantine of the Ottoman, let's say, parts of the Eptapyrion, as well as some of the places that were originally functioned as cells from the prison that was hosted there. So some of these places have been restored, and nowadays the Eptapyrion has become among one of the most important exhibition hall of the city, in which a lot of events, concerts, or athletic events take place. Let me show you some of them. Exhibitions, of course, and not only projects that are implemented by the Ephorate of Antiquities, but also in collaboration with other bodies of the city and even outside of the city. Recently in the city, for us who are living in the city, it has been established the Festival of Eptapyrion, a very, very important and a very impressive festival that really is taking place within this new place that has given from the Ministry of Culture to the disposal of the local prefecture of the city. Besides the, here you can also see a lot of people are visiting Eptapyrion, and their number has really increased very, very much during the last years. Of course, I exclude the COVID period. The other monument of UNESCO that is really has been restored and is given to the public for use of some of the very important use cultural events in the city is the Byzantine Bath, in which up to now has taken place a variety of mainly musical and musical events, concerts, as well as some exhibitions. And let me also present you here the case of Rotonda. I remind all of you that Rotonda, in its long-lasting life, served at the beginning as a pagan temple, then it was converted into a Christian church, and then into an Ottoman mosque. According to the legislation that is in use, in the monument, the holy liturgy is celebrated 13 times per year, whereas each month one cultural event takes place in the interior. Of course, in order to give the possibility to the church to celebrate the liturgy in the best way that can really secure the good condition of the monument, the Ephorate really proceeded to some works such as this one, that gave really the possibility to almost to create a modern minimal sanctuary within Rotonda. Whenever Holy Liturgy is celebrated, a lot of people are participating in this liturgy, so you can see them, as well as in the cultural part of the Rotonda. It is very impressive, not only the number of requests the ministry accepts, receives from a lot of bodies that really want to use Rotonda as an exhibition hall or as a concert hall. I have to tell you that the Central Archaeological Council in Athens, in the ministry, takes all these decisions on which request will be accepted. Up to now, all the cases are of high quality, and this is a big criterion for the ministry in order to give permission for all these events that take place, as well as some exhibitions that have really been hosted inside the Rotonda, such as that exhibition here, the glamour of the mosaic that was 1 year ago hosted in the city. At the end, lastly, I would like also to mention one last parameter for the management of Byzantine monuments of Thessaloniki. Following the environmental principles, the ministry really supports any green initiative in its protected areas. Within this framework, it is absolutely acceptable the fact that in the oldest monastery of Thessaloniki, the Holy Patriarchal and Stavropigic Monastery of Vlatadon, an incredible place of, with gardens has been configured over there within the enceinte. You can see here an aerial photo. Here is the monastery. Here is the place where the bishop lives. And here is the places of the Patriarchal Foundation. So in this amazing place, these very important, very interesting gardens are now developed, in which plants of the Bible have been planted, and as well as flowers and other herbs. And besides this green part of the city, the monastery, continuing this tradition of the animals that were living among the monks in the monastic places, even from Byzantium. Here you can see some sheep, deers, and chicken living in the monastery. More than seven deers, many chickens, and some sheep, as well as, of course, the very, very characteristic for monastic life, these peacocks that are really more than 30 nowadays at this current period. So concluding, I would like to reassure you that the Ministry of Culture makes many efforts not only to protect the monuments, to preserve them, to restore them, but also to make them accessible to everyone, to energy upgrade them, to restore them and conserve them, following one basic criterion: to keep the balance between the past and the future, and to respect their original character. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Flora, for this very interesting presentation about the cultural management in Thessaloniki. And I would like now to ask if you have any questions. We are going to accept one question per speaker in order to proceed to the next session. Dr. Charalampos Chotzakoglou has a question.
I would like also to congratulate Dr. Georgios Michailidis for his presentation. And I would like to ask if we know exactly how they were cleaning the water from the cisterns, if there was a specific way that was used, a traditional one or not, as far as he knows or he's informed.
Παρακαλώ, ανοίξτε το μικρόφωνο σας, κύριε Μιχαλίδη.
Ναι, let me answer the question. I have really studied about what is happening now, nowadays, about this. What they do is they divert the first flush. And there are mechanisms to do that. Now, as far as the past, I have not really studied the subject of how they were doing this in the past.
Okay. Do we have any questions for? Shall we proceed? Do we have any question about Mr. Pissaridis? Dr. Havasitaoglu?
I was impressed from the presentation you made on the bridges, and of course I knew and I've seen a lot of them, but I didn't know, I had not realized how many have been preserved and how important your study is. And since you have studied also, from what I've seen also in Italy, I would like to ask you if you know if we have any, in a sense of guidebook, from the Venetian period that gives instructions how to construct bridges. We have regarding the walls by the Venetians, we have for other constructions because the Venetians were very good constructors. And since we have the Venetian dominion of Cyprus, as far as you know, do we have any kind of guidebook of that period, of the Venetian period, regarding the construction of bridges, not only for Cyprus, but in general? Thank you.
In general, yes, we do have in the archives of Venice, in Marciana Bibliothek, but especially for Cyprus, I'm not sure to respond to that, as I haven't completed any further investigation. But the point is that the Venetians, we are living in the cities, not in the mountains, not in the villages. They are present in the mountains and these areas, we are limited. So most of the bridges seems that they have local craftsmanship and materials. Of course, you can see that most of them have also ogival archer, and they know how to construct from the point of view of the civil engineering. So I think that they might have something, and as I have seen also, I said also before, it's the case to start to study more these bridges, and not only the wells, the fountains. I had the opportunity of working in the Department of Antiquities many years, and many of these bridges were I worked on them during my my stage in the Department of Antiquities, and are amazing. And of course, amazing is the work that the Department of Antiquities is doing on the monuments of these bridges. And we have to support it, and with more people to have the opportunity to do it better. As I have the floor, I have to ask you also, the Department of Forest is here, to have much better signs of the bridges. Many times I get lost in the mountains that I like to, but it's also sometimes danger. And from one point of view, you are going to have less people there. But from the other point of view, if you have access to them, you are going to restore them, you are going to enjoy them. So please, not for all, for some of them, we need much more science to go there. And of course, support the Department of Antiquities, that is the only one that cares about these monuments. And I thank them. And thank also the opportunity to speak about the bridges. And there are also many other monuments that we have to promote. The wells, not only the churches that we know, but the fountains. We have so many fountains in many villages, from the medieval to the British period of our history. So I also ask to the society to think about it, how to help this situation, and I'm available for that. And as a president of ICOMOS, I would also promote this and help also the society and who is making other research to this point. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chrysanthos, and we are looking forward for a further cooperation with ICOMOS and you in order to promote this cultural management of the bridges and also in other architectural matters of architecture that can be interesting for the further public of Cyprus.
Let me add something. It's not architectural only. It's also the whole thing. I mean the environment. We forget that without the environment, are not valid all these architectural monuments. is the
beni culturali e ambientali.
I mean that I don't understand as a preservation or promotion of the bridges by having a road going until there. If you want to visit a bridge, you have to go by donkey or by camel or by foot. You have to go there. The bridge is not coming to you. This is something that you have to share and convince our politics to understand. This is civilization. Civilization is not only poetry and literature. This is civilization also. This is culture. And they have to understand it. And I'm very happy that we are discussing about the Ministry of Culture, ministry, not other, because we don't have to give less importance to the antiquities and the civilization. Let's ask for a Ministry of Culture. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Do we have any question for Dr. Karagiani?
I would like to underline on what Dr. Karagiani presented and Christos Pissarides, that it would be also a very interesting paper presenting also the way the challenges in the management of the bridges, for example, in Cyprus, as we are in Cyprus. And to approach the subject also in the same way that Dr. Karagiani presented regarding the churches, because it's very important not only to preserve them, but how we deal with them, how to teach the persons who are visiting these places to approach them. And I believe that the commissioner for the environment can play a very important role also in this part of the work.
If you allow me about this, there's great discussions going on now on the way we create sustainable visitors, sustainable tourism to maintain the spots. It is one thing to preserve them, but it's another thing to create the mechanism in which we preserve while visiting. And it's important to see how social media nowadays creates these trends into visiting places and destroy them just to take a picture and upload it on social media. So we must be careful on the way we approach visitors in such sensitive areas. And it's not only about promoting it, but promoting it to preserve it. And we are in a digital era, of course, but that is forcing us to be more careful and more suspicious than ever.
Okay, I think now that the session is closed and we can proceed to the next session about the common protection initiatives and synergies.
Yes, since that we are running out of time, we'll not have an intermission, but we are in a way not very tight regarding the schedule. In that part, I would like to thank to my special thanks to a part of persons who are contributed very much for, or not only for the webinar, but also for the whole cooperation. And in that case, I would like to start with Dr. Flora Karagiani, who had the initiative to implicate Cyprus to the whole project a long years ago. That's how we visited then with the then director of the Department of Forests, the Department of Forests also. And we're very happy that this went on until now so well. I would like to thank so much also Anastasia Hatzinikolaou, who was struggling all together with the whole project at the beginning years ago. And I'm very happy that we managed to proceed and to have this project representing also Cyprus in this big family of the countries that are taking part. I would like to underline also my thanks to to support Anu for the whole help, not only during the today webinar, but also during the whole frame of the project. And of course, Mr. Kostas Ganatsas, who is the technician who is helping us with the whole platform that we are using today. And allow me to proceed to the first paper of the next session under the title Common Protection Initiatives and Synergies. Actually, in this frame of the synergies, I have thanked all the above persons who have contributed to our project. And I give the floor to Mr. Konstantinos Themistokleous, who is an officer from the Department of Forests, who is officer in charge for the Valley of Rudias of the Paphos Forest, where the path was opened by the Department of Forests as the lead deliverable of the project. And he's going to present us the restoration of the old path between the Kykkos Monastery and the village of Panagia. That was very important this way to connect these two spots. Mr. Themistokleous, you have the floor.
Yes, good morning to everyone. I hope the sound is okay and everybody can see my screen. I will talk to you about the project done by the Department of Forests, and that was, of course, the restoration of the old path Kykkos Panagia. This old trail crosses the Pafo and Kykko Forest. Pafo and Kykko Forest are found on the western part of the island. The green lines here indicate the boundaries of Pafo Forest, which probably is the most important forest complex of the island. In the past, it was important as a grazing land for wood products and raisin production, as well as for quarry and mine products. Nowadays, of course, this part of the forest is preserved for its ecological and aesthetic value. And I have to say also that is a very important water catchment area, since it supplies water for 11 dams, and everybody knows how valuable is water in Cyprus. So Pafo Forest is about 600 square kilometers big, and is the only area in Cyprus where there are no villages. So for somebody who wanted to travel to the villages around the forest, should use a network of trails. The specific trail was crossing the Rudias Valley. As mentioned before, there were people, and some ruins indicate these activities. In the photo on your left, you see the ruins of an old chapel of Agios Epiphanios, and on the right, you see the ruins of a resin kiln. Such ruins are found scattered around the path, and of course, in all forest area. This is the Rudias Valley, and with the blue line is the path that we restored. It was used to cross the southwestern part of the forest and connect the mountainous villages and monasteries around Panagia village with Kykko Monastery and the surrounding villages. The path was used by monks, pilgrims, shepherds, merchants, and workers. The path was abandoned about in the early 50s, when a forest road network was established. We knew that there was a path from stories either written or spoken by all people. In order to find it, we planned the work in four steps. First, we had to find and use old maps. Second, we have to gather information from all people, villagers, foresters, monks, about the general route. Third, we have to combine the maps and satellite images. And fourth, it was to find the path on the ground and mark it. we search for our maps because the new maps, thus the maps after 1950s, didn't include any old path, but only the newly constructed forest roads. We were very lucky and we found maps from the National School of National Library of Scotland, and that was the first econometric survey of the island done in 1882 by Captain Kitchener. See, here on the screen, you can see the cover of this map is 15 sheets. And in our case, we used the sheet number 8 here. That was a very, very good starting point for us. These are some parts of these sheets. We were very surprised because names used on these maps, like this here, Aronaki, Anemomilos, Kiko Monastery, we still use them today, and they are very correct as regards their position. Fortunately, this map included the full length of the trail that we are looking for, and it was precise enough for our purpose. Here is another picture of this old map where I highlighted a part of the old path. The next step was to extract the data on a satellite image. So we had a general view, which we could combine with other information to find the route on the ground. This information, we found them from all people, citizens, monks, and foresters. These that you see on your screen now are maybe the last people who walked the trail back in late 40s. They were at that time 12 to 23 years old. Today are 83 to 94, and this helped us to find some critical points. Some of these critical points you see now on the screen. Of course, the most critical key point was the starting point at the Kiko Monastery. And you can see another two here. It was at places where the topography was very difficult and wanted to be very sure where to look. And then when we gather all this information, we have to go out and find the route and mark it on the ground. Of course, that was a very difficult task. As you see here, this was very difficult because the path was hidden by vegetation and erosion. And it was in sometimes very, very difficult to find the route. Some more photos of the path before to be restored. And I have to say that, especially at the beginning, we were very slow because we were not so confident and because of practical difficulties like long distances we have to walk, steep mountains, vegetation, and weather. And some points were easy and others were very difficult. And at these difficult points, you had to go 2, 3, or even more times to find the route. When we finish marking that you see now, on the screen, the works for restoration could start. We put some restoration conditions. The two most important we'll show you now. The path should follow the exact route of the old path. We didn't want to make any new paths or any new path. And restoration should be done using only hand tools to avoid any distractions done by mechanical means like mini tractors, etc. Reconstruction took place last year, 2020, on February and March, and the work included the removal of all vegetation, repair of landslide and erosion damages, as well as repair of damages on traditional stone walls found in the way of the path. Some more photos of the reconstruction. And these are the results after we here, and it was very difficult to restore it. We also find difficulties in two river crossings. So we had to construct a bridge. This you can see here. It's about 9 meters long, and it was a very, very difficult task, bearing in mind that the crossing is located deep in the forest, and all the material had to be carried out by hand at the location. The path restored under the project is about 11.2 kilometers, and is that one you see on your left. Now it's connected with a broader path network, which gives visitors the opportunity to choose a route that it suits to their purpose of their visit. Except the path restoration, Forest Department has also undertaken the task of renovating of this old forest station, which was an abandoned stone building in the deep forest. It was built in 1920s, and as you see in the pictures here, it was ready to collapse, and vegetation invaded everywhere around. And after restoration, it looks like this. All restoration works ensure that local materials such as stone and wood were used to revive its old character. And additionally, two fireplaces were restored in the building in order to provide heat for winter visitors. The forest station now is a part of the restored nature trail. So finishing my presentation, I want to say that restoring the path connected it with a broader trail network and preserving also other old ruins and monuments, witnesses of past human activities in the forest. We believe that is our contribution to the proper natural and cultural management. And of course, everybody is welcome to work with us the path. Thank you for your attention.
We thank you also, Mr. Themistocleous, and I would like to underline that the project, the Mo.Na project, offered a chance to gather this information from persons who are so old. So if this project was not here, maybe the restoration of the path would take place later, and maybe we would not have the possibility or the chance to gather this valuable information that you did. I would like also to underline that the restoration of the trail takes place by the Department of Forests with such research before, and not just to open a trail, but they are looking for in order to gather the information and to make a research before that. And it is indeed what you showed us regarding the restoration of the old forest station. It's indeed what we call monuments in nature, which is the title of our project, and you present it so well. And we proceed to the next presentation, which will take place by Maya Evstathiou, Chrysanthi Sakelakou, and Marina Vokli. All of them are working at the Ministry of Culture, of the Hellenic Ministry of Culture, in the Ephorate of Antiquities of Cyclades, and also are one of the partners of the project, and they are going to present the paper under the title Natural and Cultural Management, Common Protection Initiatives, the so far practices in the island complex of Thera, Therasia. The floor is yours by the three graces, the three ladies.
Good morning. Just a moment to find the right page. Okay. The protection of the natural and cultural environment is a multi-level process that includes from its beginning the idea of corporation of entities. The contribution of each one emerges from the responsibilities and capabilities provided by its legislation. The protection, promotion, and management of monuments in the environment belongs to the main responsibilities of the Ephorate of Antiquities of Cyclades, as a peripheral unit of the archaeological service of the Ministry of Culture and Sports. The above is an application that arises from the archaeological law and implies the protection of direct and indirect environment of the monuments, especially when the natural environment allows monuments to be constructed into an historical, operational, and aesthetic entity. The contribution of the archaeological service in that sense has an impact to the protection of the environment, and it is very important and should be appreciated accordingly. The archaeological service, being one of the oldest public services of the Greek state, took the initiative to save and promote the antiquities of the island of Thera since the 19th century with small-scale excavation, record keeping of sites and monuments, and the management on the basis of the implementation of the archaeological law. In the early of 20th century, specifically in 1902, the Archaeological Museum of Thera was founded, and Thera has its first organized archaeological site after the excavation of Hiller von Ketchen in ancient Thera, which was for decades remained the island's main attraction. Let's see, the museum and the ancient Thera. In the following decades, especially after the Second World War, the main concern was the legislative protection of antiquities by the declaration of archaeological sites and monuments. Several sites and more than 200 ancient Byzantine and post-Byzantine monuments. The rescue excavation of the island, carried out especially due to the building activity from 1980 and onwards, brought to light until today several archaeological sites and monuments, enriching our knowledge of the residential and cultural heritage of the island and help us to define Thera's protection zone. Moving forward to the year 1990, in the framework of the elaboration of the spatial planning concerning the construction activity in the countryside of Thera, fire protection zone for antiquities inside archaeological sites with land use restrictions were formed. Lately, in the 2016, archaeological sites were reformed in accordance to the survey on the basis of the needs of today, therefore being a part of the modern and useful tool available to everyone involved in order to ensure the most elaborate and efficient protection of the archaeological sites and monuments of Thera. Furthermore, in the second half of the 20th century in Thera, under the auspices of the Archaeological Society at Athens and with the supervision of archaeological service took place the systematic excavation at Akrotiri of the prehistoric city at Akrotiri, already completed 50 years and still going. The foundation of the Museum of Prehistoric Thera accommodates the finds from the excavation at Akrotiri, the foundation of the collection of ecclesiastic relics and icons from the village of Pyrgos, with the cooperation of Kyrgyz community. In addition, there is the project of enhancement ancient of ancient Thera in the frame of the third community support framework. And finally, the project of enhancement of the archaeological site at Akrotiri. All the above mentioned cases have been completed with the cooperation of other entities as well, in a larger or smaller scale, such as local communities, individuals, and other public services. Referring especially in the case of the caldera, remarkable is the effort to protect the monuments along, along with the natural environment, thus being, as a state time, their natural environment. As early as 1972, the caldera of Thera consisted from the Gulf of the island, the volcano, the islands of Mikri and Megali Kameni, Thirasia and Aspronisi, were protected as a landscape of special natural beauty, as a historical site. The initiative was to protect the caldera natural environment and especially the famous pozzolan, Thirac earth, due to the exhaustive exploitation as building material uses and the causes serious alteration to the caldera environment, which affected at the same time the monuments. We have to mention that the declaration of the archaeological site and monuments of the caldera had already started in 1967 with the declaration of the area of the Gulf of the Thera in addition to the Scaros of Hill. In 1973, the Castle of Scaros was declared as a historical site, and in 1988, all the mines of the caldera, therefore the mines at the south of the city of Thera and the site of Stelos and Megalochori, were declared as archaeological site and were demarcated with coordinates. The exhaustive exploitation brought to light the habitation horizon of the prehistoric time, together with movable and unmovable monuments of the Bronze Age. Very significant also for the protection of the caldera is the ban on construction activity in the archaeological sites, which was implemented by the decision of the Ministry of Culture in 1989, a decision that was incorporated with the 1990 Presidential Decree. The 1990 Presidential Decree, which concerned the termination of building activity and land uses in the off-plan areas of the island of Thera, set in turn a strict framework for the protection of the natural environment throughout the caldera. That in 2012, with the revision of the 1990 Presidential Decree, became even more strict. The net of the caldera protection became even wider with the declaration of modern monuments as well by the Ministry of Culture. The daily practice of rescue excavation in the caldera brings to light new facts about its archaeological wealth and early habitation of the area. Apart from the rescue excavation carried out of the, as the, a result of the mines operation, two more took place on the occasion of citizen request for reconstruction, one in the mines of Megalochori in 1980, and the other at the site of Raus in the territory of Akrotiri village in 2000. On the other hand, the initiatives for protection of antiquities and then environment found a way out in a scientific field with the collaboration of the F4A in research programs, such as the program of Thirasia. The archaeological survey carried out on the island of Thirasia from 2007 to until 2011 in the framework of the program Island Culture in a Diachronic Perspective, the case of Thirasia, conducted by the University of Crete and the Ionian University in collaboration with the former second ephorate of Byzantine antiquities and the second ephorate of prehistoric and classical antiquities, now unified as ephorate of antiquities of Cyclades. The research brought to light new data that revealed the form, the expanse, and the evolution of settlements from the prehistoric to late Byzantine period of the island. Therefore, the systematic excavation carried out from 2017 till today, with the collaboration of the University of Crete and the Ionian University, reveals a significant settlement of the Bronze Age. At this point, we mention the new expedition of the Museum of Prehistoric Thera, which is dedicated to geology and the prehistoric finds from the excavation in the mines of Caldera. The aim of this thematic expedition is to promote the antiquities along the spatial environment of the Caldera. The institutional framework set by the proclamation of the archaeological site and monuments enables various synergies with derived from F48 Corporation supervision of studies on monuments, formulation of proposal on issues such as urban planning, SWAP, residential control zone, ZOE, etc. In all the above occasions, the archaeological service took the initiative to act in favor of the protection of monuments and their environment, but at the same time sought allies in other sectors, such as universities and the local authorities with the respective municipality of Thera as the main one. In this context, the cooperation with the municipality of Thera was cultivated in a series of issues, such as researches in Thera and the program contact for the protection and promotion of antiquities within the administrative boundaries of the municipality. In this contract, several projects are included, such as the impressive expedition of the Dalek daughter, Cori, the restoration of the early Byzantine Basilica of Agia Irini in Perisa, the conservation of frescoes of Agios Georgios Phinikas, and many others. The main then aim of this contract is to protect and promote Thera's monuments. The incorporation of these two sectors in the running project, Management of Cultural and Natural Heritage of Santorini Caldera in the framework of Balkan Med, can be seen as a promising continuation of cooperation between the above mentioned and a tool for more effective protection of the cultural and natural heritage of the Caldera. On the other hand, the constantly increasing construction needs of the island, being a top tourist destination, especially Caldera, creates serious issues in the management and protection of the cultural and natural wealth of the island. Residential development project as well as tourist services project should be combined in a wise balance with the protection of the monuments and their environment. This is the big challenge we have to face in the case of Thera Therasia, to maintain the natural landscape, the cultural environment and monuments with the modern needs of the island. Thank you very much.
We thank you, Mrs. Vogli, for the very interesting presentation regarding Thera and Therasia and the cultural management and the initiatives for that, which is something very important in order to overcome the problems that we face when we have to do with the archaeological sites, the excavations, and the sustainable use of the tourists that are coming. And we have to find a way to face that, as also the Commissioner for Environment before some minutes said. And we proceed to the next paper, which will be read by Dr. Evgenia Gerousi, that will be presented by Dr. Iulia Papagiorgiou, Director of Directorate of Byzantine and Post-Byzantine Antiquities in Athens, under the title Hellenic Monuments in World Heritage List of UNESCO, Initiatives for the Protection and the Environment. Dr. Papagiorgiou, I welcome you to our webinar, and we hope to see you soon also when the situation is better also in Cyprus.
Good morning to everybody. Thank you for the invitation to this very interesting webinar, and I will read for you the presentation of Dr. Evgenia Gerousi, who has a business problem today. I will try to make the share of the screen. please help me to that. I will press share screen. Okay,
you
so
just, you yes. just need to have the PowerPoint on this on the screen and then to press the green button.
Okay.
Splendid.
Okay.
Is it okay?
Is it okay? Yes, yes.
I
yes.
think that I will. Okay. Dr. CHOTZAKOGLOU has read the title of the presentation, which is Hellenic Monuments in World Heritage List of UNESCO Initiatives for the Protection of Their Environment. The protection of cultural heritage is inextricably linked to the concept of space. Consequently, any immovable monument in Greece is protected along with its immediate environment, aiming to an integrated framework of protection and promotion. The archaeological law 3028/2002 provides for the clear delimitation of archaeological and historic sites, as well as for the establishment of protection zones in cooperation with relevant ministries. Most significantly, the protection of monuments is included in the objectives of any level land use, development, environmental and urban planning. In the context of today's seminar, I will present you two case studies of archaeological sites of the Byzantine and post-Byzantine era inscribed in the UNESCO World Heritage List that are inextricably linked to their particular environment. In the north, Metaura, okay? In the northwest of the Thessalian plain are the towering rocks of the Metaura, which is inscribed on the list of World Heritage Monuments as a mixed property. Situated in the plain of Thessaly, the Metaura site occupies a large part of the Antihasia Mountains and the region of Kalabaka and includes the rock pillars of Metaura itself and the famous monasteries built on their summits. The Metaura rock pinnacles form one of the most extraordinary landscapes in the world. Their name derives from the ancient Greek word meteoros, meaning suspended in the air. Rising over 400 meters above ground level, they were created 60 million years ago from the deltaic river deposits and have subsequently been transformed by earthquakes and sculpted by rain and wind into a variety of spectacular shapes. The monastic communities, which were founded during the 14th century, enjoyed from the 16th century onwards a renewed prosperity. Countless wall paintings, including predominant artistic trends of their time, Cretan school, Epirus school, the wall paintings from the monastery of Anapafsas, Agios Nikolaos Anapafsas on the screen, standard architectural types of church design, interesting auxiliary buildings, chapels, sacristies, cell blocks, refectories, etc., hundreds of relics in the form of icons, manuscripts, books, silver liturgical vessels, holy vestments, objects of daily use, all make Metaura the second largest monastic complex in Greece after Mount Athos. The Roussano and Hagios Stephanos convents have very active female monastic communities, whereas three monasteries, Varlam, Megalo Meteoro, and Agios Nikolaos Anapafsas, are occupied by a few monks. Due to the uniqueness of the property, Meteora attract numerous tourists every year. The large numbers of visitors create problems in the management, not only for the monastic communities, but also for environmental reasons, as there are large numbers of vehicles, buses and cars, especially during the summer months in the narrow streets of the site. Locals have abandoned traditional primary sector's activities and have focused almost exclusively on tourism, with the exception of stock breeding, which is still practiced. Also, the Ministry of Culture attempts to find a reconciliatory solution regarding several activities that take place in the area, such as rock climbing, bungee jumping, and balloons, about which the monastic communities have negative reactions. The area is a mixture of mountains at foot and foothill covered by pastures and oak dominant forests. The actual vegetation depends on altitude and orientation as much as it does on the degree of human activity. The region is crossed by Lytheos River, a tributary of the Pineios River, and of great natural interest, in part because of its riparian forest. The rocks of Meteora constitute a unique geological formation, and the region is also rich in natural cavities and caves. Fossils from the Theopetra cave reveal the presence of a variety of species going back millions of years. IUCN, the International Union for Conservation of Nature, is the global authority on the status of the natural world and the measures needed to safeguard it. It is also one of the main advisory bodies of UNESCO. According to its assessment of 2017, the area of Meteora is characterized by rich biodiversity. The Antihasia Mountains Meteora area is a designated special protection area in accordance with the EU Birds Directive and a controlled hunting area. It is also a designated site of community interest of the Natura 2000 network. 163 bird species have been recorded in the area, of which 100 nest there. 12 species are considered threatened in the last edition of the Red Data Book of Threatened Animals of Greece. The Antihasia Mountains Meteora area is one of the core breeding areas of black kites in Greece, endangered species in Greece, and vulnerable in Europe. While it holds two of the last existing territories of the Egyptian vulture in Greece, critically endangered in Greece and globally endangered. As such, and due to its geographic location, it is considered very important for the coherence of the National Natura 2000 network. The international importance of the area is further supported by the presence of several other species of birds, such as long-legged buzzards, short-toed snake eagle, black stork. Notable fauna species found at the site include 18 species of bats, brown bear, wolf, and wild cat. In the nearby forest, hills, and river valley. In the nearby forested hills and river valley, rivaling forest of Platanus orientalis and other endemic plants are found. The use of poison baits continues to threaten the survival of several endangered species inhabiting the site, especially scavenging species such as the Egyptian vulture. The species was once common and emblematic in the area of Meteora, around 10 pairs estimated in 2003. Although there is a management authority, the local Ephorate of Antiquities, for the protection of the cultural and archaeological heritage of the site as a sacred site, as well as guidelines and the general policy by the Ministry of Culture for the protection of monuments. There is no authority, neither a management plan for the management of the site's natural heritage. Although each establishment has been planned, it has not been implemented yet. According to IUCN, further delays will put at additional risk the biodiversity of the broader area, and the holistic and integrated management plan for the site is considered an essential and urgent need. The second case study is about the archaeological site of Mistras, the fortified settlement founded after the reacquisition of Constantinople by the Byzantines in 1261, flourished during the late Byzantine period between the 13th and the 15th centuries, when the empire was ruled by the Paleologi, the last Byzantine dynasty. The settlement of Mistra was one of the largest of the late Byzantine period, with the exception, of course, of Constantinople, Thessaloniki, and certain other cities surviving from late antiquity. Its well-preserved monuments strongly demonstrate its importance as one of the most notable administrative and ecclesiastical centers of its era. The city was a major piece on the political chessboard of the time and was developed and beautified as befitted its role as a center of power and culture. The city's complex history is clearly evident in its fortifications, palaces, churches, convents, houses, streets, and public squares. The painting of churches reflects the quality of the eclecticism of the art of Constantinople. Elements of Romanesque and Gothic art are also present as a result of the city's wide range of contacts during the 14th and 15th centuries. The beauty of its churches, which during the Palaiologal Renaissance were covered with magnificent frescoes, the renown of its libraries and the glory of its writers, including the philosopher Georgios Γεμιστός Πλήθων and his pupil, the intellectual Vissarion, later cardinal of the Roman Catholic Church, who brought Neoplatonic humanism to Italy, gave substance thereafter to the legend of the wonder of the Morea. Mistras is therefore a truly outstanding example of late Byzantine culture, which influenced the rest of the Mediterranean world and beyond. The location of the Byzantine city of Mistras in the eastern foothills of Mount Taygetos, and the fact that it is a walled city, issue us with an interesting challenge to study and record its flora and fauna, as well as to protect the natural world that loves and moves in the historical landscape behind its walls, enclosed and protected in the fortified wards. Life, impetuous, free, self-centered, and unrestrained, still goes on beside, between, and under the Byzantine ruins. It is a wonderful world of innocence, living in ignorance of art and historical reality. Mistras is located in a privileged geographical position in the foothills of the Taygetos mountain, which form the southernmost mountain chain in the Balkans mainland. More than 700 species of plants grow on Taygetos alone, almost half the number of the entire flora of the British Isles, and at least 80 of these are endemic to Greece. Interestingly, of the 80 species endemic to Greece, 27 or more are endemic to Taygetos and Mistras, and therefore found nowhere else in the world. By comparison to the British Isles, can boast only 16 endemic plants. When almonds are in full bloom by the end of February, Mistras becomes a magical place. One example of the endemic plants is the dwarf star of Bethlehem, a mountain flower which at Mistras only grows at the castle. The Latin name of the flower means bird's milk. The interesting flora of Mistras complements and adores the edifices, sometimes perhaps destroying parts of the buildings with which it has formed indissoluble but harmonious bonds. Nature features more prominently in Byzantine art in the later centuries, are enriching the painting of buildings with a host of picturesque details, like the vegetation around the building in a wall painting on the Pandanassa Church, circa 1430. Mistras is also a heaven for birds, like robins, which are very common winter visitors, while goldfinches are found there all year round. Peregrine falcons and kestrels fly among the clouds high above the castle tower. Both species breed in the cliffs of the nearby Taygetos gorges. Peregrines are the fastest birds in the world, as they can reach 400 kilometers per hour when nose diving in a bird hunt. Barn owls are some of the least obvious inhabitants of Mistras. Even the night wardens see them only seldom. They rest under the roof of the restored buildings and hunt for mice among the ruins. In a society which is recklessly and insatiably going away at its own natural environment, an archaeological site like Mistras provides welcome relief and an opportunity to learn about friendlier ways of life which are disappearing, but which undoubtedly constitute sanctuaries for many different creatures. According to international agreements, the protection of the natural environment around monuments or archaeological sites, as well as in the general vicinity, has now become one of the duties of those occupied in the protection of cultural heritage. The local Ephorate of Antiquities makes the best to fall within the framework of this policy. They try hard to increase people's awareness, to protect the natural environment along with the historical, and to make people realize that a walk through the past also provides an opportunity to enjoy a whole arc of biodiversity in the harmony of nature. Thank you very much for Mrs. Gerousi.
Dr. Papagiorgiou, I would like to thank you very much for the presentation of Mr. Gerousi that you read. We are impressed by these breathtaking photos that were prepared by Dr. Gerousi, and we envy you here in Cyprus that you have to your responsibility such Byzantine and post-Byzantine monuments. And I believe that we should arrange the soonest possible, as when the pandemic allows, to have you also in Cyprus to exchange experiences. I'm very sure that you have a lot of experiences regarding the way of the initiatives and the common protection, the cultural management of the monuments, and to bring us also your experience to Cyprus and to exchange all these practices that are going to be very important also for us. Thank you very much for the presentation that you read.
Thank you, Dr. Chotzakoglou, who will be very pleased to come to Cyprus and collaborate with you and see all of the magnificent monuments of Cyprus also. I have never been there. It will be very interesting for us to collaborate in Cyprus and here also in Greece with you.
Great pleasure. And this is the reason why we do this webinar, and we're very happy that we achieved that. Thank you very much once again. And from the insular and the continental Greece with the beautiful Byzantine and post-Byzantine monuments, and ancient also when we think on Thera, we are going to another place, which is a very important partner of our project, Bulgaria, where Mr. Belin Molov, if I say the name, if I pronounce it well, architect and urban planner, consultant in the field of spatial and municipal planning, is going to present us the new approach to the cultural heritage of the ancient city of Nesebar and measures for the presentation for the preservation, use and management in synergy with the requirements of nature. Nesebar is a very important Byzantine city, I would say, with so many Byzantine beautiful monuments with frescoes, decorated with frescoes. And we're looking forward to hearing what Mr. Molov has to present us. And we're also looking forward to have Bulgaria as the partner who is going to organize the next webinar. Dr. Molov, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me to participate in this very interesting webinar. And I know that I have not long time to speak. I will try to be brief and to finish in the limits of the minute. So the idea of my presentation is to follow, to see the planning process, how we plan the next period 2021-2027 in municipal planning, including the ideas and principles of this project Mo.Na. The old town of Nesever is a major factor in the socio-economic and spatial planning in the municipality of Nesever, and the measures for its protection, use and management are an integral part of the municipal development plan. Ancient town of Nesever is the only Bulgarian town with World Heritage status. It was inscribed on the UNESCO list in 1983 as an extraordinary universal value. That is why the permanent protection of this heritage is on the importance of the entire international community. Ancient Nesever is not a museum, exhibition, or preserved area. It is a living town. The great challenge is to provide a favorable living environment for the residents and guests of the city, which meet the modern needs of the people without compromising the quality of culture, heritage, and harming nature. The emphasis of the structure and content of the presentation is placed on the process of formulating the priorities and goals for the development of the town and municipality, planning the necessity measures, implementation of specific projects aimed at sustainable economic, social, and environmental results without violating the universal cultural value. This can happen through good governance and stakeholder engagement. So this is what I want to show in some details in my presentation. Introducing the main, introducing how to say the framework in which we develop our projects. The context, the current legislation necessary requires ensuring the coherence of the plan of integrated municipal development with the main strategic documents at European, national, and regional level. So here we have I don't know how do you see my presentation, because here I have some problem with the view, but never mind.
Very well.
Global goals for sustainable development, United Nations transforming our world, Agenda 2030 for sustainable development. This is the document. We have another on European level reflection paper towards a sustainable Europe by 2030, 5 investment policies. This is the document. We have Bulgarian program, Bulgaria 2030, the national strategy for regional development, the national concept for regional and spatial development, and very important on regional level, integrated territorial strategy for development of the Southeast region, and something unique in having in mind the municipal planning, special plan for protection and management of ancient town of Nesever, which is part of the municipal plan for development. Having a look on these documents, just very shortly, from World Agenda we have to stress on three of the 17 goals. One, nature, another, heritage, and education. Very important. I will speak a little bit more about education and training for administration, capacity building, and so on, in the field of ideas of Mo.Na. The second European document, it is towards a sustainable Europe by 2030. We have five policies, a smarter Europe, and we have to find in all these five policies the idea of Mo.Na, monuments and culture, a greener carbon-free Europe, a better connected Europe, a more social Europe, Europe close to the people. Then we have our document, Bulgaria 2030, with some sectoral strategies, how they connected to World 17 goals. Then the national strategy for regional development. Here I mentioned where I show where is Neseber on the sea coast between Varna and Burgas. This is a very interesting partner, stakeholder. This is the municipality of Black Sea Coast, Association of Black Sea Coast Municipalities, which plays a special role in planning process. Here we have then some illustration of the national spatial concept, spatial development concept. We have the main centers of development, the urbanization axis, Neseber is here. Very important is the southeastern region plan, which gives the priorities of development for the region, which Neseber should, Neseber municipality should respect in its planning. These priorities are sustainable forms of tourism, multifunctional agriculture, preservation, development, and promotion of cultural heritage, conservation of natural resources, climate change, biodiversity, and landscapes. And fifth priority, better digital accessibility and connectivity. Here in the current plan of municipal development, we have strategic guidelines for conservation, use and management. This is improving, these strategic guidelines are improving legal protection, improving research activities, conservation policy guidelines, promoting of value, which is very, very important in communication strategy, development of urban functional systems, development of cultural tourism, structural development, creating maps and register of cultural values, and improving management, which is very, very basic, of course. Here, for your information, the map of biodiversity and Natura 2000 in the municipality of Neseber. We have protected areas, which are mentioned here in green, and natural landscapes. Neseber is here, and you know, sunny beach is very close to it, and it is a very, very, very important task to make together develop tourism in Sunny Beach and protect this special part of Nature 2000, which is this area. I'm not going to go in details for these 10 parts of the municipal plan. Here I mentioned in underline the parts in which we have some special priorities concerning the heritage and nature in the cyber municipalities. So maybe it will be better to go to show the planning process, how it's organized in Bulgaria. From one side, we have European framework, 5 investment policies, new cohesion policy, new regulations and budget. From other side, we have Bulgarian documents, Bulgaria 2030, national strategy, sectorial strategies, integrated territorial strategy for the southern region 2021-27. Plan for protection and management of ancient town of Nsebar as a very, very important part of the package of documents in Bulgaria, especially for Nsebar, as a UNESCO site. Municipal plan for integrated development of the municipality. These are combined in one specific document. We have the special concept for regional development. And from here, we receive general strategic framework 21-27, and we answer with partnership agreement for the same period. Continue with the documents, operational programs. I want to mention general special development plan of the municipality. This is urban planning of the municipality in package with the social economic development. We have here the operational programs, and in the end, we have projects. And what is very important part of this implementation of all this package of documents is the management program. Want to mention these 5 points of view concerning the sustainability of the results. From point of view of economic point of view, from environmental point of view, from social point of view, in terms of cultural specific and traditions, we will see later not only material heritage, but traditions and habits on the territory are very important too. And in the end, in terms of good governance of the process. So some details. I start with one festival, hundreds of guests at the festival, autumn passages in the Cyber. You see the living town, environment, and everything is happened among the dozen or hundred of monuments from ancient times, from medieval and new building among them. general description of the and general view in the ancient town. This is the ancient town, and this is the new town, and here is Sunny Beach, the biggest seaside resort in Bulgaria. Historical monuments are from several eras in history. Maybe you know that the Thracian Bria, it means town, was established 5,000 years before Christ. The antiquity, late antiquity and Middle Ages, during the Ottoman Empire, Bulgarian Kingdom, Third Bulgarian Kingdom, and then the period of previous socialist period. I want to tell you, to be more closer to your impression, all these watercolors are done by me. I like very much to do this and have some exhibitions in Bulgaria with historical heritage. Part of the heritage in Sebar, this is the fortifications system coming from the ancient Mesembria. This is one of the 100 national tourist sites, the old metropolis in an Orthodox church in Sebar, Hagia Sophia. This is another church. There were before 1,000 of churches. 40 of them are preserved nowadays. A view from samples of folk architecture, one watercolor, and today the environment of the living city, the old houses from revival time, from late Turkish Empire, and shops with souvenirs nowadays. And how we combine the new architecture. I select this photo as one of the quite acceptable new architecture in the environment of old Nesebar. This is one nowadays guest house in the old town. The general configuration of the nature in the territory of the old town, it's rocks, national green, natural green, and sea. The town. Some pictures from the old town here. Street with this. These are some new houses, but you see how they are well added to the old environment in relation with the existing monuments from the revival time. Some of the main axes in the urban planning and today facilities, yacht Preston here, and this another one, the main entrance with historical fortress. And here you can see the, some of the main complex. Agora is somewhere here, where is the Hagia Sophia, which I saw before, and other places. Harmony with the old, the nature and monuments in the old town of Nisebo. Here we, I found one picture from, this is a painting, restoring the ancient town. This is the Agora. This is the Hagia Sophia, which I saw. The entrance, nothing on the big land, everything. Every town, the whole town was on this island. A photo from the end of the 19th century and nowadays. Here, this is okay. And living environment today, what is important, and we have some special projects how to use this necessary for tourism shops and artisanal activities without destroying or without harming the cultural and municipal and environmental heritage. So, this is what I wanted to share in brief with you. Thank you very much.
We thank you very much, Mr. Moloff. And I was lucky enough to visit Nisebar, and there is a wonderful, a great town. And I can understand the responsibility of preserving all these monuments, and of course, of having all these problems and the challenges, I would say, not just problems, for the management of these places and the tourism and all the problems that we face. And that's why we have different contributions from different places in order to improve the ways of dealing with monuments, with environment, with the restoration of them. And now we proceed. We would like to thank you once more that you were with us and that for the contribution of the Bulgarian side. And I would like to ask you if there is any question. I would like to ask you to close your PowerPoint.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and now to ask for any questions of the speakers, let's begin with Mr. Konstantinos Themistocleous. Dr. Iulia Papaevtichiou would like to add something on his presentation.
Good morning. Anyway, I have already sent the question to the personal. Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Is there any other question regarding Mr. Themistocleous for the restoration of the old path between Kykkos and Panagia? Any question regarding the next presentation of the island Thera and Therasia and the natural and cultural management? It was an impressive presentation, and all the photographs that you provided us with were really breathtaking. And we hope that maybe later we'll have the possibility to visit these places. Dr. Evgenia Gerousi is not with us to answer any questions. Is there any question for Mr. Belin Moloff regarding Nesebar and the cultural heritage and the synergies? Mr. Hadzisavas?
Uh, I would like to congratulate again Mr. Moloff. He reminded me of my first excavations when I was a student. And I had the chance to visit the area again 2 years ago, and I was impressed by the amount of work done at the site since my first visit.
Yes.
And I hope that after the pandemic, we can visit this site again. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Really, now it's really, really very important. We prepare our work with them, with the municipality, on the plan for the next 7 years. And of course, you know, there are some very, very specific things to add as a concrete measures and projects in the old town. And we have to be very precise and very careful not to put more asphalt and, you know, all this thing, or to build some shops and new constructions without taking care about the atmosphere, the monuments and the nature too. This is really, really important, and I'm very happy that we have a special part of the municipal document, this plan for protection of Old Nesebar.
Can I ask another question, Mr. Moloff? What yes. happened with the old museum of the city? It was housed in a very old Greek house, but I don't know what happened now.
It is the old museum. No, it is a museum in the center, in the entrance of the Cyber, on the main road, on the right side. It is still a museum.
I see you. Thank you.
No, you will see, yes.
Thank you both very much. And since we ran out of time, we have two very short presentations, which are going to impress you, I think. And allow me in that way to give the floor to the third session for the synergies, where the moderator is Dr. Eleftherios Antoniou, and will introduce us to the two next presentations.
Hello to everybody. Dear academics, friends, colleagues, honorary guests, Mrs. Klelia Basileiou, Cyprus Commissioner for the Environment, Dr. Eleftherios Antoniou, member of the Council of the Society of Cypriot Studies, and I will be your moderator of the last session. As far as you know, due to this extraordinary situation of the COVID-19 pandemic, unfortunately, we cannot have the event with physical presence, but we are happy to see you all through Zoom. So we are looking forward to share knowledge and exchange ideas. Our first speaker is Mr. Petros Mouios. He is teaching at the Nea Smyrni in Athens Lyceum, and he is vice director of the school. And he is charge of the team of the film. Along with some pupils, he created following short film under the title The Soul of Water, which presents the role of water and monuments in the Turkish occupied area of Kythrea and comparison with Kakopetria. This short film received the first prize in the Pan-Cyprian and Pan-Hellenic competition of schools in cooperation with Society of Cypriot Studies in the frame of Mo.Na, Monuments and in Natura project. So I will give the floor to Mr. Petros Mouios to say a few words, and then we will see the film.
Hello, I hope you can hear me.
Yes.
First of all, I'm happy to be here with you in this webinar. I apologize for having my camera off, but I'm neither at home or at the office, so I'm on the move right now.
Okay.
So my name is Petros Mouios, and I am the vice principal of Nea Smyrni High School in Athens, and also a cinematographer. And in my school, I am the coordinator of an arts team, which revolves around short movies project and volunteering work. This team has won 20 awards in Greece, one of which is about the documentary that I will present. About a year ago, before the pandemic broke out, we collaborated with the Society of Cypriot Studies, and we created a film which is called The Soul of Water. It's actually a documentary which explores the connection, the association between nature and water and the Turkish invasion and occupation in Cyprus. We had actually two 16-year-old students working on this film, Ioannis and Alkis. And I have to tell you that they were really, really enthusiastic about the project, and they worked with ebullience on writing the screenplay and also doing all the research that was needed for this project. Now, a few things about the film, about the screenplay. Actually, it is developed in a three-pillar thematic: abandoned buildings and destroyed cultural monuments, people who passed away or were forced to flee their homeland, and still life. I mean, the degrading natural landscape. Unfortunately, we only had 2 days to make the film, so it's not as professional as we would like. And part of the movie was shot in the town of Kythrea. Kythrea was once a very live place with 5,000 people living there. It used to be surrounded by fertile fields, water streams, and cultivated farmlands. Nowadays, the land is arid and only vaguely reminiscent of the past. So, summarizing, we kind of tried to, like, with a sensitive and we tried a sensitive and metaphysical approach to underline how politics and politicians divided into two parts the elements of nature. But I will say no more. I hope you will enjoy the film. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mouios. And now we have to see the presentation.
38 minutes. The duration.
Οι αρχαίοι θεωρούσαν ότι η γη ήταν επίπεδη και γύρω της περιελίσσονταν ο ωκεανός. Πίστευαν ότι τα νερά όλων των ποταμών και των πηγών προέρχονταν από τον ωκεανό, αφού περνούσαν από τον Άδη και τους νεκρούς. Σε αυτόν τον ωκεανό, πάνω από κοιτάσματα φυσικού αερίου στην Ανατολική Μεσόγειο, φαίνεται να παίρνει ανάσα η Κύπρος, να γαληνεύει από τα πάθη και τις πολεμικές των λαών. Η Κύπρος δεν είναι ένα νησί σαν όλα τα άλλα. Οι άνθρωποι χώρισαν τα ένα ως αδιαίρετα από τη φύση του στοιχεία, τα βουνά, τις πεδιάδες, τα νερά. Ο διαχωρισμός της Κύπρου είναι σήμερα πολύ εμφανής στην πρωτεύουσα Λευκωσία. Η πόλη χωρίζεται σε δύο τμήματα με φράκτες, βαρέλια, τείχους και σειρματοπλέγματα.
Τον Ιούλιο και τον Αύγουστο του 1974 ο τουρκικός στρατός εισέβαλε και κατέλαβε το 36,2% της Κύπρου. Έκτοτε, μια νεκρά ζώνη χωρίζει το νησί στο βόρειο τουρκοκρατούμενο τμήμα από το νότιο ελεύθερο της Κυπριακής Δημοκρατίας.
Ναι, βέβαια.
Τα σημάδια από σφαίρες και βλήματα ακόμα και σήμερα παραμένουν άλλαλοι αυτόπτες μάρτυρες των οδομαχιών του Αυγούστου του 1974. Η Λευκοσία μοιράζεται τη μοίρα άλλων τόπων, όπως το παρελθόν το Βερολίνο και σήμερα το τείχος στη Δυτική Όχθη. Το ζήτημα της λύσης και της ένωσης προβάλλει πάντα επίκαιρο και προς το παρόν άλυτο.
Στην τουρκική εισβολή ακολούθησε η καταστροφή της πολιτιστικής κληρονομιάς, ο επικισμός του νησιού από κατοίκους της Ανατολίας και ο ξεριζωμός 200.000 Ελλήνων της Κύπρου. Μεταξύ αυτών συμπεριλαμβάνονται και 5.000 κάτοικοι της Κωμόπολης της Κυθρέας.
Η Κυθρέα βρίσκεται στις παρυφές του Πενταδάκτυλου, 27 χιλιόμετρα από την Κερίνια, το λιμάνι που έγινε η απόβαση των Τούρκων. Πρόκειται για τους αρχαίους Χίτρους που σύμφωνα με το μύθο ιδρύθηκαν από το δισέγγονο του Θησέα, τον Χίτρο. Για αιώνες εδώ έρεε το κεφαλόβρισο που διαμόρφωνε εντυπωσιακούς βιότοπους αδρεύοντας ταυτόχρονα μια τεράστια έκταση, όπως μαρτυρεί και το Ρωμαϊκό Υδραγωγείο. Μετά την εισβολή έγιναν γεωτρήσεις που είχαν ως αποτέλεσμα να χαθούν τα νερά του Κεφαλοβρύσου και έτσι η Κυθρέα ελάχιστα θυμίζει το έφορο παρελθόν της. Για να μπορέσει κάποιος σήμερα να έχει μια εικόνα για το πώς ήταν η Κυθρέα, ίσως πρέπει να οδηγήσει αρκετά χιλιόμετρα δυτικότερα. Εκεί, στις παρυφές της οροσειράς του Τροόδους, βρίσκεται η Κακοπετριά. Είναι ένα πολύ ζωντανό χωριό με εκατοντάδες επισκέπτες τα Σαββατοκύριακα. Βασικό χαρακτηριστικό της είναι ο ποταμός Καρκώτης, ο οποίος περνάει μέσα από το χωριό. Το ζωοδόχο του νερό χρησιμοποιήθηκε ως πηγή ενέργειας που τροφοδοτούσε τους μήλους, οι οποίοι άλεθαν το σιτάρι του χωριού για αιώνες. Η σύγκριση με την Κυθρέα, που επίσης είχε πολλούς νερόμηλους, όπως αυτός της Ελιάς, είναι αναπόφευκτη. Ο Ιωάννης Ηλιάδης, διευθυντής του Βυζαντινού Μουσείου της Κύπρου, θυμάται τα παιδικά του χρόνια.
Το 1974, όταν έγινε η τουρκική εισβολή, ήμουν 6 χρόνων. Θυμάμαι την πράσινη περιοχή της Κυθρέας, τα ριάκια να διασχίζουν την Κωμόπολη, να πηγαίνω με τα ξαδέρφια μου να μαζεύω καβούρια και τα καλοκαίρια να αποθέτουμε τα καρπούζια στα παγωμένα νερά του Κεφαλοβρύσου για να κρυώσουν τα καρπούζια.
Σαν τις βαγγέλιος τα χείλη, όπου κάνει το σαφύρι, σαν τις βαγγέλιος τα χείλη.
Σήμερα μόνο με θλίψη αντικρίζει κάποιος την πόλη της Κυθρέας. Όλα έχουν ξεραθεί, δεν υπάρχει πλέον το νερό του Κεφαλοβρύσου και δυστυχώς τίποτα δεν θυμίζει την πόλη που όλοι αγαπήσαμε.
Το σπίτι, τα δοχεία νερού περιμένουν να αναβλήσει πάλι το Κεφαλόβρυσο. Τα κλειδιά ανυπομονούν να ανοίξουν μια πόρτα που δεν υπάρχει πια. Ο καθρέπτης, πάνω από τον παλιό νεροχύτη, θυμάται όλα τα πρόσωπα που κοιτάχτηκαν μέσα του. αυτά τα πρόσωπα ίσως τώρα να προσεύχονται σε κάποια εκκλησία στην ελεύθερη Κύπρο, όπως αυτή του Άγιου Κασιανού στη Λευκοσία, πάνω σχεδόν στην πράσινη γραμμή. Αντίθετα, στους βεβηλωμένους στα κατεχόμενα ναούς, μόνο τα πουλιά μπορούν να ακούν ακόμα τον απόϊχο τροπαρίων χαρμολύπης. Στην Κακοπετριά, το μοναστήρι του Αγίου Νικολάου της Στέγης εξακολουθεί να δεσπόζει πάνω από τον καρκότη ποταμό. Σε μια τοιχογραφία απεικονίζεται η τιμωρία των Αγίων 40 μαρτύρων που τους έριξαν μια χειμωνιάτικη νύχτα στα νερά μιας παγωμένης λίμνης. Σήμερα κάποιοι άλλοι μάρτυρες, οι νεκροί και αγνοούμενοι της εισβολής, συνομιλούν με τους προγόνους τους στην άνυδρη πλέον πεδιάδα της Μεσαωρίας, πάνω από τους βεβηλωμένους τάφους και τους ασφοδέλους.
Thank you, Mr. Muyos and Chubirs, for this interesting presentation. Our second speaker is Dr. Eliades Ioannis, who will present on talk and photographic exhibition on water and monuments at the Troodos Forest. Dr. Eliades is director of the Byzantine Museum of the Archbishop Makarios III Foundation, and he is also General Secretary of the Byzantine Commission of Cyprus and Vice President of the Council of Society of Cypriot Studies. So, Dr. Eliades, you are kindly requested to join the event.
Hello, you hear me?
Yes. Okay. Please take the floor.
One of the activities undertaken by the Society of Cypriot Studies is the preparation of a photographic exhibition named Water and Monuments at the Troodos Forest. The aim of this exhibition is to highlight the relation between the water and the cultural monuments of the forest of Troodos Mountains. The aim of this exhibition is to highlight the relation between the water and the cultural monuments of the forest of Troodos Mountains. And the Paphos forest is over here. In the Paphos forest is found the monastery of Kykkos, founded in the 12th century. The establishment of monasteries always required for the needs of the brotherhood water resources as well as cisterns for its storage. In the area where the monastery of Kykkos was founded, both are preserved to this day. The water jet that comes from the Troodos Mountains supplies water to the monastery, and today it is bottled and distributed throughout Cyprus. At the same time, the slope of the yard of the monastery led the rainwater to a series of cisterns, which have also been preserved to this day. In the descriptions of the monastery of Kykkos, it is mentioned that the construction of the large cistern on the south side of the Catholicon of the monastery began during the abbot of Kykkos Sophronios in the 18th century. Next to the cistern was built a water tank where monastic products are offered in this room today, from which water was pumped by a manganese well. Two more cisterns for collecting rainwater were in the upper courtyard, one of which survives as built in the 18th century, while the other was located in the area of the monastery, where today is the photographic museum of Cypriot liberation struggle. At the spot Xistarouda, located circa 7.5 kilometers southeastern from the monastery of Kykkos, there is a path which, after about 2 kilometers, leads to a cluster of rocks from which springs the agiasma of the monastery. Its earliest reference goes back to the description of Kykkos of 1782, which mentions the miracle of a monk half willing by thirst, whose prayers were heard by the Virgin Mary, and the holy spring was miraculously revealed. Since then, many other miracles took place there, which were even depicted in an engraving of the monastery of Kykkos. The rumor of the miraculous agiasma is also mirrored in a patriarchal document of 1815, on the eve of the commemoration of the birth of Virgin Mary, September 8th. Monks of Kykkos were going to the agiasma, and under the sound of bells from the monastery, celebrated the Vesper. The holy water is visited to this day by many faithful who pray by tying and hanging small pieces of cloth on an adjacent tree and drink the holy water to be healed. One of the deliveries of the project is the nature trail through Kykkos Monastery to Panagia Village, as Konstantinos Themistocleos explained before. The Department of Forests has undertaken the restoration of an old nature trail which runs for around 11 kilometers through the Kykkos Panagia Valley. The nature trail is located inside the deep and untapped National Forest of Paphos. The restored trail has followed strictly the old trail path, and the work included cleaning the nature trail from obstructing vegetation, stones and soil that has piled up over the years, trimming trees that were hanging over the trail path, building traditional stone terraces in specific places to minimize soil erosion from the flow of minor springs. This trail used to connect the monastery of Kykkos in the left with that of Panagia Christoriadisa near Panagia Village. In Trodos area are 10 painted churches inscribed in the World Heritage List, which bear outstanding testimony to Byzantine civilization and are well conserved examples of rural religious architecture and provide evidence for the links between Eastern and Western Christian art. The 10 churches, which date from the middle to the late Byzantine period, variously from the early 11th to the early 16th centuries, contain Byzantine metropolitan art of the highest quality. They also display elements that are specific to Cyprus and that were determined by its geography, history, and climate of the Troodos region. The architecture of these small churches is unique. And today we had Professor Marius Pelekanos, who explained this type. This architecture is confined to the Troodos range and almost certainly of indigenous origin. Steep wooden roofs with locally manufactured flat tiles protect the churches from the rain and occasionally snow. The 10 churches are St. Nicholas Stagis in Kakopetria, the Transfiguration of the Savior in Palechori, Virgin Mary for Viotissa in Nikitari, Virgin Mary to Araka in Lagudera, Virgin Mary in Mutulas, St. John Labatistis in Kalopanagiotis, Archangel Michael in Pedulas, Holy Cross in Agiasmati, in Platanistasa, Virgin Mary Podithu in Galata, and Holy Cross in Pelendri. The history of Cyprus is steeped in dramatic turns and twists of fate. Troodos area presents three different cases of abandoned villages. Among them, one of the most characteristic is the village of Pano Amiantos. It is located halfway between a rather prosperous village of Kato Amiantos and Troodos. Most of its houses and buildings are desolate. The reasons for this are predominantly economic. At a certain point during the last century, the area was home to asbestos quarry. The scale of work carried out there was so massive that one can still see its remains from many of the observation points in the Troodos. The quarry is truly gigantic and even futuristic looking. More than 5,000 people worked at the quarry during the heyday. These workers were also the main inhabitants of the nowadays abandoned village of Pano Amiantos. Then in 1988, the company that oversaw the work in the quarry went bankrupt and the locals were forced to gradually leave the area. The case of the villages Trozena and Suskiu, originally inhabited by Turkish Cypriots, have been deserted after the Turkish invasion and occupation of the northern part of the island. The Turkish Cypriots were moved to the north. A different case is the village of Kikardo. It is a typical outcome of urbanization. More and more people are looking to leave their home villages and relocate to large cities. This is what happened to Kikardo. Slowly, but surely more and more people kept living it until it became completely empty. Built during the Venetian rule, 1489 until 1571, a series of hidden bridges are dotted around the villages of Cyprus. And also about the bridges we heard before, Chrysanthos Pissarides. The bridges form part of the old camel trail built by the Venetians to extract anything valuable they found on the island, such as copper from Perapedi village. Kelephos Bridge in Paphos Forest is the most known bridge on the island. Its popularity is due to the fact that it's the largest stone bridge ever built in Cyprus and goes back over river Diarisos. Elia Bridge is built where the river of Kaminaria and Diarisos meet. The name of the bridge translates to olive, and as the name suggests, there was a vast reach of olive trees in the area. On both sides of the bridge, there are carving crosses considered to be its main characteristics. Ruthia Bridge is nestled in the western side of Paphos Forest. The waters that flow through it will eventually arrive at the Asprokremos Reservoir after the meandering journey through the Paphos countryside. Numerous streams spring from the Troodos Forest that feed the rivers Diarisos and Hapotami that flow into the southern sea area of Paphos. The rivers Setrachos and Karkotis that flow into the Gulf of Morphou and the river Kouris that flows into the Gulf of Episcopi. Inside the Troodos Forest are the two most famous waterfalls of Cyprus, Calydonia and Mesopotamos. The waterfall of Calydonia is located in the north of Pano Platres. It's 12 meters high, and it is the largest waterfall in Cyprus. Its waters belong to a tributary of the Krios River that flows in the area. to the southeast of the waterfall of Caledonia is the Mesopotamos waterfall, and is about 9 meters, meters high, created by the fall of the waters of Mesopotamos, a tributary of the Kouris. Due to the long dry summers, the island's water supply relies on the dams, and when the winter rain overflows them, a picturesque spectacle is devised. In Troodos area, there are 6 dams filled with 17 species of fish. Fishing is allowed in all dams with a special permission. Καφίζης Dam is in the heart of Paphos Forest in the Xeros Potamos Valley. Καλαπαναγιώτης Dam is found in Μαραθάσα Valley and is filled by the Σέτραχος River. This is the favorite place of fishermen. The species you are likely to find there are rainbow trout, the brown trout, albernus, and mosquito fish. In Palihori Dam is constructed over the river Cambiou. Fishing, And then Prodromos Dam is a small dam near the village of Prodromos, 5 kilometers away from the Troodos Square. Xyliatos Dam is located between Xyliatos and Lagoudera villages, about 45 kilometers from Nicosia. Aspropyrgos Dam is the second largest in Cyprus. It was built at an altitude of about 100 meters above sea level. It is located 16 kilometers east of the city of Paphos. Due to poor rainfall, the dam rarely overflows due to poor rainfall. The Troodos mountain range is considered one of the most important mountain habitats for plants in the whole of Europe. This rich biodiversity is due to the great variety of habitats that are formed because of the differences of altitude, particular geology, the presence of water, and the local terrain. The most representative examples of the influence of geology are the serpentifilous endemics of Troodos, such as Onosma troodi, Asinos troodi, Sinoglossum troodi, and Alisum troodi, as well as many plants that are only found in igneous rocks, such as Silene levigata and Rosa chionistre, and those that are found in the transitional of igneous zone of limestone and ophiolite rocks such as Ilin, Gemata, and plant on outcrops
rocks,
such as Sedum Cyprium and Sedum Microstachium. The fauna of Troodos reflects the rich flora and the wide spectrum of habitats it creates for many insects, birds, and animals, many of which are endemic to the region. The most characteristic of them is the Cyprus mouflon. It is a wild sheep, and this subspecies is found only in Cyprus and dates back 10,000 years. It is a large animal, the largest of the local wildlife fauna, and was endangered for many years as hunters consider it to be a quite a prize. It is estimated that there are now over 3,000 individuals that roam the forests of the Troodos and Paphos Mountains. The ornithological value of the area is reflected in the designation of special protection areas for birds. Among the most important species are the Europe-wide endangered Bonellis eagle, the highly endangered Griffon vulture, and many other birds of prey, such as Northern goshawk, the long-legged buzzard, and others. Among reptiles and amphibians, an important place belongs to the endemic species of Cyprus snake, the endangered water snake Natrix natrix, which has been recorded at the Xyliatos Dam. At this point, I would like to thank the archives
of the Department of Forests and also those of the Society of Cypriot Studies. And a special thanks to the private archives of Sotiris Kurtis, Kostas Americanos, and Maria Mikhail. I would like to thank from my heart Dr. Savas Ezekiel and Nikos Kassinos of the Cyprus Department of Forests for their cooperation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Iliadis, for this really interesting presentation. Now, regarding Petros Mouios' presentation, as far as I noticed, we have the pleasure of having with us in the forum the mayor of Kythrea, Dr. Petros Kareklas. Dr. Kareklas, would you like to address the audience for a few words?
Thank you very much, Lefteri. I followed only a part of your really very interesting webinar, which dealt with so very important issues. It is always a pleasure for me to see initiatives which refer to the cultural and natural heritage, like the Kykkos Forest, but also other interesting things we have seen about other countries. First, I would like to congratulate one more time Mr. Petros Mouios and the pupils, who really created an excellent short-term film on my hometown, Kythrea, and also others who cooperated with them, like my friend Charalampos CHOTZAKOGLOU and Ioannis ELIADES, who are always we are in very close cooperation on many issues. It is a subject you have presented today, which is of special interest to me, because I am involved also in the council, managing council of the SDN, SDSN network, which has been created by the United Nations, as you know, on preserving cultural heritage and promoting sustainable development all over the world. You know maybe that Professor Jeffrey Sachs of the Columbia University is the advisor of the United Nations Secretary General Guterres. Now a branch has been created in Cyprus as well, Cyprus SDSN. And the main subject, the main objective is to implement the 17 Sustainable Development Goals presented by the United Nations. And of course, a lot of work has to be done. Cyprus is a little bit behind in many in implementing those goals. So again, my warmest congratulations. We are really very proud as Kythrea people for this short film has been created. You know, the painful story of our town and also the whole occupied area in the northern part of the Republic of Cyprus. We are struggling all over the world trying to help the political initiatives so that the solution can be found to this terrible situation. Things are very difficult. We know the positions of the other side, but we still hope is there. We are trying to achieve the goal of freeing this occupied area so that occupation troops will withdraw and people who are the real owners, who are the proud people who live there for years and centuries, their ancestors, and who have created all this cultural heritage so that they would be in the position again to enjoy this land. Thank you very much. Congratulations and all the best for the future. Thank you very much.
I would like to thank you, Dr. Kareklas. And now I would like also to give the floor to the Cyprus Commissioner for the Environment, Mrs. Klelia Basileiou, for a few words and already in comments. Mrs. Basileiou.
Thank you, Mr. Antonio. Again, sincere thanks to the Society of Cyprus Studies for the excellent job they carry on. This project, the partners, the speakers, the moderators today, it all reminded me of the work we've done to create the UNESCO Global Geopark of Troodos. And all the presentations reminded me of the reasons that I didn't want to include anything specific in my welcoming speech. So I preferred into staying in general. And listening to the presentation, I realized why. Working for Troodos for so many years, I had the opportunity to work for the 10 UNESCO monuments, Byzantine painted churches. And listening to the presentation from Mrs. Papa Eftihiou, if I'm not mistaken, the colors they used to paint the churches. It's from the sulfur springs of the geology of Troodos, the forest, the ecosystems, the biodiversity. I would really like to thank the Cyprus Antiquities Department for the excellent job they do. Of course, the Forestry Department, the Geology Department, and from my point of view, all we need is a holistic approach to keep working for the environment and for the culture. And from my point of view, we cannot separate them at any time. All we need to focus on is on the materials we use in order to keep on living, in order to be sustainable and turn back to the earth in a more sustainable way. All I've seen from Troodos and Paphos Forest, of course, is the people and culture and customs and the need to face the threats to avoid fires that could really put the place in a danger zone and other weather phenomena, and invest in people to continue cultivate local products, farmers to coexist with the biodiversity, as well as work with the tourism ministry and the new coming Ministry of Culture in order to collect all the important things we listened to today in one basket and make it a holistic, integrated and sustainable approach that actually can give us a lot. More thanks to our friends from Greece and Bulgaria for their participation today and the really, really important information they shared. And as far as two comments, I need to comment from what we received from Mrs. Papa Eftihiou about the starting point of the trail to Kykkos Monastery. The start was in Paphos. In Chrysalignodissa Monastery is just a mid station. And now with the Ministry of Tourism and the Forestry Department, we're trying to promote this trail and bring it back to life because it's really, really, really important. And to Mrs. Hamatou, of course, Troodos at 2019 has a new strategic plan. And thankfully, for the first time, we are paying attention to the mountain area at last. And very good luck to the commissioner of Troodos for the responsibility he has taken on. Thank you. And Mr. Petros Mouios for the video. I'm trying to find the proper words to express how touching it was and what it needs to be said. To speak to the heart and soul, it only takes congratulations.
Thank you, Mrs. Basileiou. Now, are there already questions and or any comments from anyone for Eliades and Mouios?
Well, if I can...
Yes, Mrs. Karayani.
Yes. Oh, excuse me, we are in the same room, two computers.
It's okay then.
I would like, from my side as well, to express my deep gratitude to Mr. Mouyos for this astonishing film that he presented to us, he created and presented to us. I think it was very touching, and it really, what is more touching is the fact that the young people living in another country, through their eyes, that we saw all this issue related to the waters of Cyprus. If we had time, I would really like to ask Mr. Mouyos, how did their team experience this thing? But it, maybe in another case, we will have the opportunity to do that. But congratulations. And I would also like to congratulate Mr. Eliadis. I was so much impressed with these photos that he presented to us. I've been in Cyprus several times, but watching these presentations, I had the impression that it was for another country. I mean, it's such a hidden treasure, and I'm very, very much impressed and very grateful to him and to the Society of Cypriot Studies, as well as to the Department of Forest, which, if I understood well, provided you with several photos of these amazing natural landscapes. We would really, speaking on behalf of the Mo.Na Project, I would really like to see this exhibition in one of our common events, maybe the symposium in Athens, if you can bring it there, because it would be a nice opportunity to see also this aspect of Cyprus, which is not so well, we are not so well familiar with this aspect. Yeah. And of course, I would like to congratulate all of you for participation and for the organizing of such a webinar. We learned a lot of things. And as I said, we had the opportunity to really evaluate in a different way Cyprus in our minds. Focusing on an aspect that it was not so well known for us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Karayani. And now I have to give
the ακούμε, κύριε, ναι.
Thank you very much, I said. And I would like to give the floor now to Dr. CHOTZAKOGLOU in order to close the whole session.
Dear partners and dear participants, I would also like to thank you very, very much for your participation, your contributions, your presentations. And I think the word that I would like to underline to stay in our memory is the Greek word in English, also synergies. And I think this word is what we have to keep from this webinar, that cooperating as we cooperated so good with the Department of Forests and the other parts here in Cyprus is something that we have to make it as our weapon, so to say, in order to proceed. Synergy and cooperation, and a great thank you for everything and to all of you. Thank you very much. Have a nice day. Have a nice weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you, same there.